Hey, this is part two of our Brothers War set review. So I'll be going through all of the rares in all the different colors and mythic rares and retro artifacts. And retro artifacts are special to the Brothers War. There's going to be one in every pack, so they are going to be kind of important to know, even if you don't, they're more build arounds. So this is going to be a lot of fun. Really quick, I'm going to go through the system explanation again. You can skip this part if you've already seen it. But I grade on a scale of 1 to 10. 1 is never play me, 2 is do your best not to play me, 3 is filler, 4 is above average. You're going to have a lot of filler cards in your deck. Don't worry too much. You want to try and fill it with 4s and above if you can, but that's tough. 5 is a strong card. 6 is something that you always play in that color. 7 is a reason to play that color. 8 is a card that you really want to make fit. You put a lot of work into making it fit. Sometimes that means that they take a little work. You always play a 9, and 10 you always play and it wins you the game. And I use a slightly different system than other people who do set reviews. So the floor is the worst the card will be. So in a vacuum, on an empty board, if your deck is not built to it, that's usually going to be the floor. A ceiling is the best that card can be, and there's lots of build arounds at the rare. There's going to be more of a difference between the floor and the ceiling on rares than a lot of the commons and uncommons. Build around sideboard cards, cards that are difficult to play with, those tend to have a higher ceiling and a higher effort to get there. The effort value is the difficulty required to bring the card from its floor to its ceiling, and it can mean a few different things, but it's best to take care of that on a card-by-card basis. High efforts tend to be cards that you gotta put some work into building with. It's not easy. Alright, so we're gonna go ahead and get started with our multicolored cards. So today I'm gonna go multicolored cards, regular artifacts, lands, and then Wooburg, all the colors, and then the retro artifacts, because the retro artifacts help to have a basis when we talk about them. They're pretty cool. All right, here we go. So first up, we have Deathbloom Ritualist. It makes a lot of mana, and I've been putting this into a category of cards for this set called bridge cards, because you have lots of cards early. They're very important. So you have early game, mid game, and late game cards in this set, and a few cards that work on all three. Deathbloom Ritualist will make a huge amount of mana, but it doesn't ramp you until you already have 5 mana. Oh, let me put the chat on. Well, I won't do that right now. I'll do that a little later. People are around. So, the Deathbloom Ritualist is a bridge card. If you have 10 drops and 9 drops, cards that you want to make sure that you can cast, then you might run the Deathbloom Ritualist. So, there's a lot of self-mill. It's not terribly difficult to build a card that lets this card make a huge amount of mana. It is difficult to use that mana. So make sure you have a use for it before you grab the Deathbloom Ritualist. It's usually going to be pretty bad, but there are huge cards in this set. So this card, it would be bad in other sets. But in this set specifically, there's enough 9 and 10 drops that you can make this work. There are reasons to run it. There's some X spells. There's some cards that you can activate multiple times. You can treat this like a power stone of its own. But it's not usually going to be a good idea to first pick, or if you want to grab it, make sure you're building around it from the beginning. I gave it a floor of 2, a ceiling of 5. It averages out to be a 3. It's still a 3-5. It's a playable card, but it's not something that you want to take like a removal spell over or a big important uncommon. Ajar, Loyal Bodyguard. This is a vanilla creature. I gave it a floor of 4 and a ceiling of 5. It's really difficult to get it up to that effort ceiling of 5, but there are a few cards that care about legendary permanence. Hajar is a 4 in this set because a 2-mana 3-3 is exactly what red-green wants. It's really hard to get a 3-3 in red-green, but red-green wants efficient creatures. They want creatures that can attack through your opponents. There's a lot of 2-mana 2-2s, and you really want to be able to attack through them, and Hajar does that. So if you are a red-green deck, a 2-mana 3-3 is exactly what you're looking for. It's still a pretty good card, but don't give too much stock to the second ability. You might save a creature sometimes, but it's a lot of effort for not a lot of payoff. Harbin, Vanguard Aviator. Similar to Hajar, it's a 2-mana 3-2 flyer, and that's great. A 2-mana 3-2 flyer will punch in for 9 damage before your opponent kills it. They have to spend a real removal spell on it, and they usually will, because 3 power turn is pretty good. Like Delver's Secrets is a 3 power flyer on turn 2. If you attack with 5 or more soldiers to activate it, you have won the game. You don't have to think too much past that. So I gave it a floor of 4 and a ceiling of 7, just because having a late game payoff like that is really nice on your early game attackers, but it is an early game attacker first and foremost. It's better in draft, so like if you pack one, pick one Harbin in draft, you're going to be happy. You spend your picks picking up white-blue soldiers. In sealed, it's not going to be worth putting a whole lot of effort into. So you don't want to like, you might end up with an aggressive white-blue sealed deck, But this card does not necessarily work with a lot of the archetypes that you're going to be opening in your sealed pool. So be a little careful. It is worth playing, but not always worth putting a lot of effort into playing. Unlike the Legions to Ashes. This is a just fantastic removal spell. It's very efficient. It exiles any non-land permanent, and that's really relevant. There's a lot of things you need to kill. Early game, you may need to kill something small. Late game, you need to kill something big. But the thing about Legions to Ashes is it kills everything big in the late game. So, like, lots of the cards that people use in the late game to avoid single target removal spells are, like, 6-mana make 4/1/1 soldiers, and Legion to Ashes kills them all. Or if your opponent is trying to play their 10-power creature, and they've made... If your opponent makes 3 power stones... That's reasonable. Lots of people are going to make 3 power stones. If your opponent makes 7 power stones, your opponent is playing a power stone deck, and your opponent is about to play something huge. And you can either let them play that huge thing, and there's lots of scary ETBs, there are lots of huge creatures with haste, but Legion's Ashes can take out every power stone. It's one of the only ways to take out every power stone. And it's not even your power stones too. Legion's to Ashes will kill all of your opponent's 7, 8, 10 power stones without killing any of yours. And lots of decks are going to have a Power Stone plan, so this is a scary card. Be a little aware of it. Like, you're not going to want to put too much effort into playing around it, but if you're on a deck with 6 Power Stones in play, and you have 3 more Power Stones in hand, and you don't need those Power Stones, or if you have the option of something else to play, remember that Legion Stashes exists. Mishra, claimed by Gix. So, I should have mentioned for the meld cards, I'm going to cover the actual melded together cards at the end. It is not worth factoring the meld into the rating. If you manage to meld a creature, congratulations. That's awesome. Be proud of that. Take a screenshot and tag me on Twitter. I'd be really happy to see it. But meld is mostly a constructed mechanic. The other thing about meld is every piece, there's 3 meld creatures. All 6 meld creatures are great. So Mishra, I gave it a floor of a 5, and I gave it a rating of a 5 because it's usually going to be a 5. It's usually going to be a 4-mana 3-5 that drains like 3-6 life. It's a great attacker. It's very efficient on rate. Treat it like a 4-mana 6-5. 4-mana 6-5 is really good. It's not something you want to warp your whole draft around. It's worth splashing if you need a way to close out a game. So like red, less so than black. Black is good at closing out games. Red is less good at closing out games. Like red is good at getting those last few points in, and you're gonna have a lot of situations where it's like, well, I just need to throw 5 creatures at them to drain them for 5, and then a lot of my creatures will die, and I'll drain them for 3 next turn, and then I'll have lethal. So that going around blockers, punching through even if they have a big pile of blockers, is pretty solid. It's a good way to finish a game. 5 is good. 5 is a strong card. All right, Mishra number 2, the Tamer of Macfawa. So this one's a little bit better because it has a little bit more utility. The rate is a little worse. It's a 5-mana 4-4 instead of a 5-mana or 4-mana 6-5. But it's got a lot more utility altogether. Everything about Mishra added together is good. Like a 5-mana 4-4 is fine. Ward Sacrifice Permanent means that it's always going to be a 2-for-1, even if that one is a Power Stone or a land. And having Unearth is awesome. If you can unearth artifacts that aren't creatures. There's lots of artifacts that have comes into play abilities, and lots of artifacts that have leaves play abilities, and it's going to be worth unearthing the non-creature artifacts, and sometimes you are just going to unearth your huge prototypes and bash. And because there are a lot of prototypes, 10-mana, 7-mana, 8-mana creatures, that have unearthed 5, unearthed 7, and you can save a lot of mana by unearthing them with Mishra. We're going to go over a lot of those. And I'll talk about Mishra a little more then, because this Mishra is only a rare, not a mythic. Queen Kayla Bin Krug. What a name. I love her name. This is a really cool card. A 3-mana 2-3 is not the best rate, but it's not the worst rate either. And she's still a legendary creature. She's still a human noble. She's not a soldier, but being legendary is relevant. But her ability is pretty cool. She mildly functions. If you get to replace your hand with her ability and return 1 permanent into play, that's a value. And you're digging yourself further and further into your deck too. It is sorcery speed only, but like sometimes you're gonna play her on turn 3 and then on turn 4, pitch your hand and put 3 bodies into play and replace your hand. And you can just keep digging. She's gonna be worth splashing in the black white CMC 3 or less deck a lot. And you do wanna build with her in mind. Just rummaging away cards is not terrible either. She's a pretty good card. I gave her a 6 because you're gonna generate some value out of her. I'm going to raise the effort level on her. I think she's a little bit more work than medium, because you want to build around her altogether, and you want to time her activation carefully. Because if you just activate her on turn 4, you can't wait until your opponent's end step. You have to do it on your turn. But you can generate a lot of value with Queen Caleb and Krug. All right, first Planeswalker of the set is Saheeli Filigree Master. She's very good. Her floor is 6. She's not going to be that variable. I gave her ceiling of 7 because she does self-enable. So you can play her minus her put down 2 Thopters and attack something with those Thopters and attack, punch through. Or you can chump block with one of them to keep her alive, and then next turn scry one and draw a card. If you already have artifacts, you can plus her the turn she comes down to scry one and draw a card. So then even if they kill her, she has replaced herself. And then activate her to make the emblem next turn. She's pretty cool. She's less of an ult to win the game Planeswalker and more of a grind value out of her over time. But you'll get 3 cards worth of value out of her pretty easily. So that puts her at a 6. The Serenth Great Worm. So it's got landfall. And it's not just your lands. It's your opponent's lands too. Whenever either player's land enters a battlefield, for any reason, you get a Power Stone token. The Serenth is a bridge card, like the first one that I showed you this set. The Deathwing Ritualist. It bridges you to your 10 drops and to your crazy expensive activations. But it's a must-answer threat until then. So it's a 6 mana 7-6, and I gave it a floor of a 5 because that a 6 mana 7-6 is pretty good. And sometimes they'll just kill it. It's still a 6 mana 7-6. They can kill it before it gains value, because if you play it on turn 6, then you don't want to, you'll play your land and then the Serenth Great Worm. And then if they have a kill spell, then it dies. But if they have an arrest or something that keeps it tapped, you'll just generate a huge number of Power Stones, and those will be there after the Great Worm dies for you to cast your next threat. It's sort of weird to put a mana doubler on your 6 drop, because it then generates double mana for each land you play after 6. So it's still cool, but it does run out. Oh, hey, Plastic. How's it going? No worries. If you have any questions, just ask. I like this card, though. But we're going through the rares, and if there's anything you want to argue, you just let me know. All right, Thanos the Toymaker. Love this card. Pretty bad. So it only duplicates birds and beasts. There are 5 beasts in the set and 1 bird. However, they're mostly pretty good. There's only, unfortunately, one of the beasts is black, one of the beasts is red. But if you have like 5, you're going to have drafts with like 4 or 5. The offset of Baloths and the rock that makes a Power Stone are very good. So you get to play, you will have situations. You don't want to first pick Thanos, but you will have games where you have 3 Baloths and 2 rocks. If you have 6 creatures that this can duplicate, Thanos becomes good. You need to have, if Thanos gets to duplicate 1 creature, then it's worth it. That's hard to do, which is why I gave it such a high effort. But you will have situations where Thanos functions as a 5 in your deck. I love Thanos. He's one of my favorite characters in the book. He would see birds and make mechanical birds, and he liked making toys for like Urza's kid and different people's kids, and then he would get captured and people would be like, we gotta rescue Thanos, he's so wholesome. But then they also use his designs to like make flying bird soldiers. Great character. Don't thank me, thank nature for his wondrous design. Takeja, Dig Site Mentor. This is Urza and Mishra's mentor. I think it's a little weird that she's a 4-3, but she did teach everyone to surveil and be vigilant, which is really cool of her. I like her. So she is, let me move the chat over. So she's solid. Being 3 colors is a little difficult. Like, it's Warwick. You can run 3 color cards in this format. You can run 3 colored cards more easily than have a 3 colored deck. It's easier to splash a few cards than it is to run solidly 3 colors, which does make her ability a little bit weaker. Being a 4-cost 4-3 that gives your whole team, so if only she had vigilance and surveil, she would still be good. But the fact that she gives your whole team surveil lets you dig really well. So if you have something that filters your mana, some way that makes it a little easier to get green, green, white, white, blue, blue too, then you can dig for that. She's a very cool card, and she will do a good amount of work over the course of a game. She's only medium effort, because she's kind of hard to cast. She's going to be a little hard to get into play on turn four, and that's when you really want her, because then she smooths out your draws the rest of the game. But she's still very powerful. All right, Urza. Urza number one is Mythic. We're going to ignore that second ability, because if you have Urza Lord Protector and then Might Stone Weak Stone, you're going to win. He's just solid. Like, he's a strong card. Usually is going to be at a ceiling of a 5, not at the floor of a 4. Because you're going to get 2-3 mana out of value out of Urza over the course of the game. Like, just if you have Urza, Might Stone, and Weak Stone, then you can play the Might Stone and Weak Stone on turn 4, and then activate Urza on turn 5. But generally, it's going to be a 3-mana 2-4, which is good stats. It's a good blocker that nets you a lot of mana over the course of the game. Strong without being busted, unlike next Urza, Prince of Crew. Artifact creatures you control get +2/+2 is huge. So if this were just a 4-cost 2/3 Lord that gave all that tempered steel for all of your artifacts, it would be great. Because there's a lot of soldiers, there's a lot of 1/1 artifact creatures floating around. If you get to activate Urza even once, that's a huge amount of value, because it makes 3/3 clones of artifacts, and you can use power stones to activate his ability. Urza is very strong. He works with artifact creatures, and he works with power stones. He works best with both. So if you are just a white-blue artifact creatures deck, then he's going to be pretty good. He's a little awkward just because white-blue is soldiers, and it has fewer easy artifacts than other colors. But it has artifacts, and a lot of them at common, and you're going to want to pick them up if you start with Urza. He's going to be worth a first pick often. He's going to be an 8 often if you pick him pack one, pick one. But he's not always worth, you know, running 2 new colors for. He's not always worth even splashing a color unless you have the artifacts and the power stones to go with him. Excuse me. If you have artifacts and power stones, then he's excellent. Oops, I'm sorry. I forgot you could see my screen. Excuse me. All right. So next we have some honorary multicolored cards. The first is Blade Coil Serpent. So Blade Coil Serpent is pretty cool. If you are paying, it's a really well designed and weirdly elegant card. So like, if you pay blue 4 for a Blade Coil Serpent and draw a card, then you're 6-mana 5/4 that draws a card on ETB. That's pretty good. If you go blue black red, then it will make them discard a card, attack for 6, all very good. This is a very modular creature, and you have a lot of control over the mode. So you can cast this off of 4 power stones and 2 blue, and it'll be fine. And this is a weird card because, like, let's say you pick it, pack one, pick one. Well, you're not committed to all 3 of these colors. You are only committed to one of these colors, less so red. You're more interested in playing it with blue or black. But, like, you don't need to go blue to cast Blade Coil Serpent. Blue and 4 power zones is great. It's pretty rare that you'll have 8 blue mana unless you have a way to filter your mana, or 8 black mana or 8 red mana, which there are ways to filter your mana. And that's why the ceiling is a little higher, so you can get it up to an 8 if you've got good ways to filter. It's not terribly difficult to filter, so I gave it a 7, just because I4 that replaces itself is a 7. Very strong and really well designed and very cool art. And then its opposite is the Clay Champion. So green or white. If you pay 4 green, it's an 8/8. If you pay 2 green and 2 white, it is a 5/5 that gives 2 power. As long as you are putting colored mana into this, you are getting a better rate than any other creature at 4. It's pretty good. And just like the Blade Coil Serpent, it doesn't commit you to green or white, but it commits you to 1. You don't want to play this card as just an artifact. You want to play it as green or white. These are more hybrid cards. These two are more hybrid cards than multicolored cards, but they're pretty cool. I like them both. All right, Cityscape Leveler. First really busted creature we've seen. That's not true. We've seen lots of busted creatures. But this one is... this one is worth running. The power level on this is huge. There's a lot. We've seen other 8 drops, and they're more like incidental. You would play them if you could already make power stones. You would play them if you had a way to bridge the gap to play your mid-game mana ramp creatures out, or like There's a 5 mana, make 3 power stones, gain 3 life. This is why you play those cards. It is worth building your deck around getting to 8 mana for the Cityscape leveler. Because, yeah, you give him a power stone. But in general, you're going, like, if your opponent has good answers for this, then you're going to cast it on turn 6 or 7, kill their best card, they'll kill it, then you unearth it and hit them for 8 and kill their second best card. It's really very strong. Cards like these, you're going to have lots of games, you're going to hear lots of stories out of this set where people say, well, I was about to win, but then my opponent played a Cityscape leveler and it got to attack twice before I killed it. And then they unearth it. And then they blinked it. It's really, really very strong. I mean, there's a few creatures at this power level at this cost. There's a few 6, 7, 8, and 9 drops that are worth pulling out all the stops to cast. And this is one of them. Liberator, Urza's Battleship. This card is sweet and it's legendary. So being a flash legendary artifact is relevant. You will have you have cards that care about legends coming into play. You have cards that care about artifacts coming into play. We saw Lauren, the white artifact. This is a flash way to trigger Lauren that can also be picked up with Lauren. This is a legendary creature that Lauren, that feeds Lauren and gets picked up by Lauren when he comes in. Giving every artifact flash is very good. There's a lot of artifacts that care about having flash, like that's something you get so much better. Like you can flash in a Cityscape leveler, kill something that is attacking and block something else. It's a good card. If you can grow this once, it's great. If you can grow it 3 times, then you have a 4-5 flyer that has already done its job. It's a good card. You can even, so like if you play this on turn 3, then turn 4 you play an artifact and grow it. You don't have to cast an artifact spell. It is any spell. So like, you can cast this on their end step, untap, play a 4-drop spell, play a 2-drop spell, or a 2-mana and a 3-mana spell, attack for 3. Or you can cast it on their, when they attack, and then play a 2-mana spell to grow it and block as a 2-3 in the same turn, kill that 2-2 before your flyers just kills them. Alright, Portal to Phyrexia. So I gave this a very similar rating. I gave it the exact same rating as a Cityscape leveler. It doesn't have Unearth, but it does have a bigger impact the turn it comes into play. And it does the same thing, where if you untap with this card, you win the game. So, they're going to sacrifice their 3 worst creatures, but that might be all of their creatures. And then every turn after that, you get the best creature in a graveyard into play. Very strong card. This is another card. So these huge mythic artifacts, these are worth building your deck around. If you open a Portal to Phyrexia, then play the Power Stone deck, get you some, get lots of Power Stone generators, find the open color, because all the colors are reasonably good at making Power Stones, and then take all the Power Stone generators from that color to get to cast your strong rare artifacts. They did a pretty good job of designing the artifact rares in this set. They're mostly mythic and expensive. Like, these feel like mythic rares. They're very strong cards. Next up, we have the Might Stone and the Weak Stone. So these are the stones that are now Urza's Eyes. One of them bonded with Mishra, one of them bonded with Urza. This card always does what you want it to do. So you can sometimes use the Power Stone mana. Like, it is 2 Power Stones. But you will always need to either kill a creature or draw 2 cards. If you don't need to do either of those, either you can't lose that game or you can't win that game. This is a kill spell you can play with Power Stones, or a divination you can play with Power Stones. And it comes in untapped. This is a Power Stone that comes in untapped. You get to play it and then use a Power Stone mana in the same turn, which you might be able to do if you cast this with Power Stones. Card is very strong, and we are ignoring the fact that it melds. Up next, we have the Stasis Coffin. This is a cool card. It is bad. It is also cool. So this is the coffin that Sotanos survives the end of the world because he builds the Stasis Coffin to keep some people alive. And he is in it when the world ends. I would love to see somebody find a good use for this, but there just isn't one right now that I see. It might have some constructive play. It exiles itself, so if you could recur this, it would be a weird and fun engine. It can save you from one thing, but like if your opponent has a 10-10 and a 5-5 in play, they're just not, and you have a a 10-10 and a 5-5 in play, they're just not going to bother attacking with both their creatures. They're not going to commit to killing you while the Stasis Coffin is in play. And there is a mind game aspect to that, but this is a lot of mana for a fog. If there were more cards like Target Player Sacrifices a Creature, destroy all creatures Target Player controls. Target Player divides your piles. Like if you could respond to like a fact or fiction with this card, it would be solid. There are a few. So there's a few like rares that Target Players. So I did give it a sideboard grade, but generally this card is not going to be worth a pick. Be aware if you have it, because there are a few cards that you might want to. There's a few commands. Let me check. This one. Nope. Yeah, commands. There's a few commands in this set, that target. But that's about it. Stonebrain card's terrible. Like it takes one card away, but it will always be from your opponent. But it will always be negative card advantage. This will go into every single constructed format. But you can't afford to be at negative card advantage. Sometimes. Pre-release as well. Hey Burgalus, how's it going? Nice to meet you. We're doing my set review today. If you have any questions, you be sure to ask and let me. Oops. Shoot, I usually use my browser to talk to people on Twitch. So you can see it. How's it going? So this is Stonebrain. Stonebrain is a good card. It is not good for limited, but sometimes in sealed. So in your pre-release, you might have a pool that cannot deal at all with one of the cards that your opponent has, and then and only then can you side this in. But you do not want this card. You do not want to have to run it. You can't recur it, and it will always be negative card advantage. Like if you have to deal with your opponent's Saheeli and you Stonebrain Saheeli and it's in their hand, then it replays itself. There's no way to generate card advantage. It just preemptively answers with one threat. If your opponent you can build single threat decks with Diabolic Intent, but you should not assume that your opponent only has one threat. All right, moving on. Thran Spider. So I gave this a 4. This card's kind of weird. A 3-mana 2/4 with reach is a great rate. It blocks really well, and there's a lot of 2/2 and 3/3 flyers that being able to block is useful. Giving your opponent a Power Stone is a lot, and they get to use that Power Stone first. The fact that you get a Power Stone too is nice. In theory, you can use it better than them, but it's a risk. There's a very good chance that your opponent is better at using their Power Stones than you are, even if you built a really good deck for using Power Stones. Oh, great. Well, ask if you have questions. Tonight's stream is mostly for me to get this content out. I want people to be able to refer to this if they open a rare that they don't know how to evaluate at the pre-release. But it's also a good way to just see maybe things you might have missed about rares. But if people disagree with me on a rating, arguing it is something that I'm willing to use. Like, if you can argue a card is better or worse, I'll change my rating on it. All right, moving on. Blast Zone! So this is a cool card. This card has been in other limited sets and has been very expensive in other limited sets. This limited set has Power Stones, which means you can very easily play the Blast Zone with 2 Power Stones out, get it up to 2 counters, and kill a real threat. It is a little awkward because sometimes a lot of cards care about having colored mana, and even the monocolored decks care about having swamps or plains. So it does end up being not quite as high as it could. I gave it a floor of 3 and a ceiling of 5, just because a lot of decks is going to be a land with some upside, but not a ton. And a lot of card decks is going to be a great removal spell that is also a land, which that's always nice. Hey, Dragon Jack. If you want to talk about specifics to Dragon Jack, let me know. If you have any questions about your pre-release as it happens. This one is more of a, like, you can be like, I open a Blast Zone. Should I play Blast Zone? Well, this is when you should play Blast Zone. You should play Blast Zone when you aren't a monocolored deck, when you aren't a 3-colored deck, and when you have a few Power Stones to make it work. Okay. Up next is the Hall of Tagzin. This card I actually changed my rating on. It's pretty cool. It filters your mana, which is valuable. It lets you splash these off-color cards or maybe a prototype cost. It's pretty cool. And then it's 4 and tap to make a Power Stone. But then it's 3 and tap to make a Power Stone. And then it's 2 and tap to make a Power Stone. And then you just tap the 4 Power Stones it made, and you just have a Power Stone machine making one every turn. Card is fantastic. It's going to be worth including in just about any deck. It just has fewer restrictions on it than Blast Zone. because of that filtering aspect. It also, you can just play it and it lets you filter an existing power stone into whatever color you need. So it's fantastic fixing. It's a little expensive to get started, but if you have a few power stones already, then you can just start making a lot of power stones every turn. And that means that it ends up, I'm going to raise a ceiling on this card. That means that it ends up being pretty good in every deck. Oh, I'm really glad. So this card will end up being useful in just about every deck, which is why I raise the ceiling a little bit. You just have to be careful that you don't care about having enough swamps or plains or islands. But it's a nice card. All right, just a few more lands. Mishra's Foundry. I kept thinking, oh, this is a cool colorless land, and then I kept raising the rank a little bit and a little bit. Card's just great. It is a land that attacks for two, that there's only five assembly workers. But if you have them, they all get a little better because of Mishra's Foundry. A land that attacks is great. I actually did think it was only one to turn into a creature, but still, I think I stand by this rating. Lands that attack are nice to have. Fortified Beachhead. So this is a land, you can use it to fix. Even if you don't have soldiers, it will still be fine fixing for white or for blue for splashing that color. And there's going to be a lot of situations where you want to splash white or blue for something like Urza or the Yoshin Soldier Lord. There's a lot of good splashables in this set. Fortified Beachhead does that, and you won't use that soldier ability too much, but if you are, it makes a huge difference. Lands with activated abilities are strong. Argoth, Sanctum of Nature. I'm going to raise this. I'm going to lower Mishra's Foundry to a 5 because this card's just better than Mishra's Foundry, and I wanted to raise this to a 6. I'm going to raise this to a 6. The only reason this card's a little awkward is because you can kill yourself. It doesn't make unlimited bears. Milling yourself 3 is a non-zero cost. This 100% of green decks want this. It's a very powerful card. Making tokens on lands, whoops, is very rare and very difficult. Yes, so this is a ranking of 1 to 10, and I'm going to go over the ranking again in just a moment, King Gex. I'm going to finish the Painlands. So I gave all three Painlands the same ranking. This is a format where taking a point of damage is relevant. And the Painlands are a little weird. Don't put your Painlands into your red-white deck. So, like, you don't want Battlefield Forge in a red-white deck. You don't want Brushland in a green-white deck. You don't want Llanowar Wastes in a black-green deck. You want Llanowar Wastes in a green-blue deck that has a few black cards, or in a blue-black deck that has a few green cards. Because you don't want to be taking a point of damage every time you have to land. But they're still pretty good. I would rather have Evolving Wilds in a lot of situations, but there are a few cards, most of the ones we looked at the beginning, stuff like Hajar, which make it worth taking that point of damage early. It is less of a liability than it was in Dominaria, because you have more artifacts. You're going to be able to use that waste-colored mana more, and there's no domain cards. They're still good. So like these were 2s in Dominaria, and they're 3s in this set. All right, so really quick before I get to the next for the rest of the colors, I rake on a system of 1 to 10. So I rank on a system of 1 to 10, and I use a slightly different system than other streamers. So 1 is a card you should never play. 2 is do your best not to play it. Sometimes you'll have them. 3 tends to be filler. They're not terrible cards, but they don't do anything that special. 4 is something above average. 5 is something that's very strong. 6 is something that you will always play if you're in that color. 7 is something that will pull you into that color. 8 is a card that you really just want to make fit. That's where you want your Painlands, your filtering. You will make concessions in your picks to make that card fit. 9 is something that you will always play, and 10 is something that wins the game. And there's actually a card in this set that would have been a 10 if it weren't in a different set. But for the in general, 8s, 9s, and 10s are pretty rare, and the fact that we're in the rares and mythics means that we're going to have a lot more 8s, 9s, and 10s. We have not had a 10 yet in any set I've done. There are 3 of them in this set. Alright, moving on to the cards with colors. So I did divide... I went back and forth on all of the artifacts, and eventually I went with... If it has a colored mana symbol somewhere on it, I put it in with that color. There are 3 tens in this set, and you might be able to guess what they are. this card is fantastic. I'm going to take a 30-second break to drink some water. I needed that. All right, so... The The other thing that I do is I give everything an effort value. So like an effort value of low means that it's pretty easy to bridge the gap from a 6 to a 7. And an effort value of high means that it's a sideboard card, it's hard to play with, or you have to build your deck around it to get the full value. Autonomous Assembler, you don't have to do that. Autonomous Assembler is, so the reason that I gave it the floor of a 6 is because it's a 6 if you can't prototype it. If you are paying 5 mana for a 4-5 with Vigilance, that grows every turn because it can target itself. It is itself an assembly worker. Then you're ecstatic. But if you play this on turn 2 and then attack for 2 and then grow it and play a 2-drop, you're going to win the game. And the thing about Autonomous Assembler is if your opponent also plays a 2-drop. So if you're on the play and you play a 2-mana 2-2 Autonomous Assembler, and your opponent plays a 2-mana 2-2, you attack with the Autonomous Assembler, they can't block. Even if you're trying to play a 3-drop that turn, you don't want to use your mana, they can't block because if they block, then you're going to activate it after attacking. Because it's vigilant, it gets to attack and activate. The card is very good. You should always play this, but there are cards you will take over it if you aren't white. If you are in white, you will always take this card. Ideally, you want to be able to cast it for both modes, but since it's prototype is the opposite of kicker. So you need to be base white to have access to both modes. You don't get to draw your white mana later. Very strong to start us off. All right, up next we have In the Trenches. So if this card were a Glorious Anthem, which this would be a 4 or 5, this card is going to be really fascinating to play with. So like, the fact that it is a Glorious Anthem that turns into an Oblivion Ring later makes it better than either card, obviously. But if you play this on turn 3, suddenly your opponent has to play the rest of the game knowing that you're going to O-Ring something on turn 6. Like, how do they do that? Do they lean more into tokens? Do they avoid playing cards that... Like, your opponent doesn't get to play their 6-drop. If your opponent plays a 6-drop, you in the trenches it. Activating this once takes away a lot of the power of this card, but at a cost of exiling whatever your opponent cares about the most. It's going to be interesting to play with and against, especially with all the tiny bodies and many soldiers that white makes. It's a very powerful card. Yeah, it's a mythic. This is a cool mythic. It captures the feeling of being in the trenches, although maybe adds a little bit of whimsy to it. Which is not necessarily a good thing. All right, Kalo's Command. This card is very efficient, so don't think a 4 is a bad card. This is still a good card. So a 4 is, I am playing a 3-mana 2-2 artifact creature that gains a planes. This is almost always going to be a 2-for-1, but it's bad. It's a bad 2 cards. It's better than Divination because it affects the border right away. So if you make a 2-2 and that gets a planes, that's great. If you just need a 3-3 on board, that's great. If you already have a 2-2, you can make a 2-2 and attack for 6 and then have a 3-3 left over. Or just gaining 2 life and scrying 2. Or maybe you have a board wipe or you think your opponent has a board wipe. Then you're just going to go grab a planes, gain 2 life, scry 2. It's great. It's a 2-for-1, but it is the two things that matter the most to you. This is one of the cheaper commands and it does some good work. Kayla's Reconstruction. So this is our first massive disparity. So this is a pure build around, and I know it seems like it plays like Collected Company at sorcery speed. So if you're paying, you need to have a deck. This is a late game thing to do in the CMC 3 or less deck, which is the white black archetype, but it's going to be a little bit difficult to cast in the white black deck, and this will never be worth casting for more than 7. Really, X equals 3 is going to be the sweet spot. If you can pay 6 mana and hit 3 creatures with converted mana cost 3 or less in your top 7 cards or artifacts, then you're pretty happy. But that's a whole deck. You have to construct your entire deck to do that. If you have a regular curve with 3-3 drops, 4-4 drops, or 3-3 drops, 3-4 drops, 2-5 drops, 2-6 drops, then you're going to have too many misses. So like at X equals 4, how likely are 4 of the top 7 cards of your library to be hits on this card? So you don't usually want to play this for, like, 3 is the sweet spot, but if you can play this for X equals 3 and hit 3-3 drops, you're going to win that game. It's great. But you have to construct your whole deck around it. So normally this is only a 3. It might even be as low as a 2 because you can whiff. I'm going to drop the rating by 1. But, like, if you have the CMC 3 drop deck, or you are prepared to build it so that almost all of your deck has a converted mana cost of 3 and fits these criteria, then it'll do some good work. It's a cool card. I like the design on this one a lot. Anyone can destroy a continent. You have the vision to rebuild one. All right. Next is Lauren of the Third Path. So this is the other Lauren. And she works really well with the other Lauren. She's a 3-mana 2-1 with Vigilance that disenchants when it comes into play. That's great. Reclamation Sage is great. The legendary aspect is nice. White cares a little bit more about other things. And that bottom ability is fascinating. So you and target opponent each draw a card. You can gain value out of that. So if you are the converted mana cost 3 or less deck, then you are more likely to be able to play that card than your opponent. Because if your opponent is on the Power Stone deck, they're going to be drawing 7 drops and 8 drops and 9 drops, and you're just going to be drawing more cheap creatures that you can play out. And you can use that ability after you attack. So I gave this a ceiling of 7 because you can build a pretty cool deck out of using that. She also triggers the other Lauren because she's a legendary creature. And if you can recur her or blink her, then being able to disenchant something works really well. So like, let's say your opponent is on the Power Stone deck. Then you get to slow your opponent down by destroying an artifact or enchantment. Oh, thank you so much for the follow. I appreciate it, Hillbilly. Nice to meet you. So if you have this at a 3-mana spell that disenchants, maybe you're hitting Power Stone, maybe you're hitting a relevant creature, but you are slowing down your opponent's Power Stone deck. Then you both start drawing cards, and your opponent is going to be drawing 8 drops, maybe more prototypes, hopefully weaker than yours, but you're drawing on average cards that you can cast because they are much cheaper, because this is the CMC 3 or less deck. This is all getting her up to a 7. She's always going to be that 5 because she's going to be a 2-for-1. When you need to draw a card more than your opponent needs to draw a card, you'll know. And Lauren is very good for finding that. She's got lots of relevant type lines as well. All right. Mural, Shield of Argive. Holy soldiers, Batman. What a card. This card wins the game. Be aware of what you are stopping your opponent from doing. Try and figure out what you're stopping your opponent from doing. Because, like, sometimes your opponent's going to have a giant growth, and they're not going to be able to cast it the whole game. And you won't know. You will kill them before you get to know that they had a giant growth. I like cards that have deceptive value like this. Very cool. She's so cool. Like, she just attacks and attacks. Like, the first time she attacks, she only makes 1 soldier. And the second time, she makes 3 soldiers, or 2 soldiers, and then 6 soldiers. She doubles your soldiers every time, on top of being a legend and an efficient body. And if you're building your deck right, which is why your ceiling is so high, then you win 2-drop soldier, 3-drop soldier, mural, 5-drop soldier, attack, make 4 soldiers, and they can't do anything about it. Like, that's the thing, is if you untap with Mural and your opponent doesn't have a bigger creature, or if you have one of the mini green protection spells, then you get to free attack because you know your opponent is going to kill her on the attack. She's very good. All right, moving on. I think this is the best white rare. Platoon Dispenser. A 5-mana 4-6. So the reason I gave it a floor of a 6 is because that's if you're not white. If you have no white mana in your deck and you just have a 5-mana 4-6 that draws a card every turn, card is fantastic. Like, you don't have to be able to activate it to make a soldier. You don't have to be able to unearth it to attack for 4, draw a card, and make a soldier. You just have a 5-mana 4-6 that you can cast with Power Stones that draws a card every turn. If you are a white deck and you play this, it draws a card the turn it comes down, so it replays itself before they can kill it. If they kill it, it'll draw another card after you unearth it. And if you are a Power Stone deck that happens to have a lot of Power Stones and some white mana, then you can play the Platoon Dispenser and make 2 soldiers to draw a card in the same turn. Card just went, like, if you untap with this card and you're the white deck, you win the game. Very strong. So usually it's going to be an 8. I gave it a ceiling of a 9 because sometimes you'll get to untap with it. Like, an 8 is if they kill it the turn it comes down, because they have to kill it the turn it comes down. This doesn't even combo with Mural. This combos with itself. This card is so good. Yeah, Mural is Soldiers is good in... Hey, Megum. Hey, person. I think Mural is good enough to be a commander in Historic, in regular Commander, and to make Soldiers viable in Standard. I think Soldiers is just good in Standard right now. Because, I mean, we haven't even gotten through all the Soldier rares. And this one makes Soldiers. All right. Rescue Retriever, the goodest boy, possibly goodest girl, unclear. So I gave it a floor of a 3 because if you have zero soldiers in your deck, which, you know, more likely you have zero soldiers in play. If you have zero soldiers in play, I still like a 5-mana 3/3 flash. But, like, you can play this on, like, you can make a big attack, let your opponent block some stuff, and blow them out by slamming down the Rescue Retriever. This is a card you can predict a little bit, and a card you can bluff a little bit. Any card that can be predicted can also be bluffed. You want a few other soldiers to go with it. You don't need a ton. Like, if you are a dedicated soldier deck, I gave it a ceiling of 7. This is a 7 in the soldier deck. If you have 12 other soldiers, this card is very strong. I gave it an effort of medium because you need to build the soldier deck. You also need to think about when you're playing this, because you don't always want to jam it on turn 5. You don't always want to swing out to get it down on turn 5. But great card, fun to play with, and not that strong in a vacuum. Best in the soldier deck. Look at it. It's so cute. Medicine and morale. I like that it having a dog on the battlefield brings morale. Sipping my tea. Siege Veteran. So, this card is Luminarch at its floor. It is Luminarch Aspirant. It doesn't matter that it costs 3 mana. Because it comes down a turn later than Luminarch Aspirant, but it doesn't have to give its first counter to itself. This card is so good. This is... Soldiers is very, very strong in this set. It's great in Limited. It's great in Constructed. But, like, this is a great example of that. So, if you ignore the bottom ability, this card is worth splashing for. You don't need to run this card in a Soldier deck. You can splash this card in whatever other deck you want off of some artifact. You don't just want to jam it in with the Plains, but if you have like some Evolving Wilds, maybe the Soldier lands, maybe some Pain lands, it's worth splashing. Because it sits there and takes over the game. If it only grew itself, it would still be playable, but like every deck has something that you're going to want to grow. And it just slowly lets you take over combat, both on offense and defense. It's very strong. If you are making soldiers when your other soldiers die, that's gravy. The first ability is strong enough. Great card. Let me make this a little bigger. It's just gonna pump up the chat overlay. So it's easier to read all of your nice things. There we go. All right, moving on. Soul Partition. This card's so cool. It is not that strong. You're gonna find lots of good times to use it. It's kind of weird because, like, you don't get to blink something. Like, you can blink some smaller things, but blinking your opponent's prototype lets them reset it, even at 2 more mana. But you can't blink your own prototype to reset, like, to make it come back on the bigger half, like, with a momentary blink or an ephemerate. Still a solid card. It's a good spell. You're going to find a lot of uses for it. But it is card disadvantage. You have to work. I could put it at like a ceiling of 5 with a higher effort. You'll want to try and respond. It's better against some decks than others. I am going to raise the ceiling on it, but I'm going to leave it at a 3. Because some decks, like the green decks that are trying to pump things up, or the red decks that are trying to combo kill you, Soul Partition is a lot better against. But there's so many ETBs in this set that exiling something is a liability often. Saving your own creature is relevant, and dealing with your opponent's spells in response to a pump spell is relevant. So, like, it has a place. It might be slightly better than filler in a lot of decks, but have things to do with it, or it's going to just be filler. If you're only targeting your opponent's spells with this, it's going to be filler. Good filler. Like, reasonable filler. But it's not always going to be worth the first pick. So this Steel Seraph, I gave it a floor of a 4, because that's what the floor is if you can't cast it for white mana. If you're only ever paying 6 mana off Power Stones for a 5-4 that divvies out abilities like this, you're winning. This is a really good subset of abilities, too, because sometimes your opponent's going to have a 10-10, and you need to leave a blocker back, maybe something with Death Touch, and you give it Vigilance. Sometimes you're going to want to give something else Flying to punch through. Sometimes you're going to want to give itself Lifelink to win a race. But if you play this on turn 3, you're winning every combat the rest of the game. The card is spectacular. This is one of the best cheaper spells. Like, this is one of the highest ratings I gave to something that you can cast for 3 mana. There is one card that you can cast for 3 mana that I gave a 9 to. Yeah, Karn got amazing in this set. Hey, Ben. Nice to meet you. How you doing today? It is good. It's good Disperse Kulrath, but it's still Disperse. And Disperse is still a 3. I think Disperse is actually great in this set. It's one of the best it's been. All right, moving on. Takeja's Welcome. This card's cool. It's a build around, but it's not a huge effort to build around. So, like, this is one of the better payoffs for the CMC 3 or less deck. But it's not cast. You don't have to cast a creature with converted mana cost 3 or less. So, like, there's a few... I mean, if you have, like, creature, there's some creatures that make soldiers when they die or stoppers when they die, and they will die on your opponent's turn, and you'll get to draw a card. You want to draw 3 cards off of Takeja's Welcome. If you can get 3 triggers off of this, you're pretty happy. That's a 4. The ceiling is higher because in the CMC 3 or less deck, card is phenomenal. You do have to put some thought into your deck building with Takeja's Welcome, but it's a great card. All right, moving on to Ursa's Seelix. So this is a really cool card. Yeah, thanks, Gorath. So this card's really cool and really bad. 7 mana to sweep is bad. And it's a lot of times 7 mana to sweep. So like the Zendikar land that had 8 mana to destroy on all land permanents, that card was pretty good. But Ursa's Seelix is weird because a lot of times the control decks, the kind of decks that want to run this card, want lands. You want lands. You like if you have 7 mana to cast. So if you have 7 mana to cast a spell, to cast and activate it in the same turn, whether you did it with power stones or did it with lands, you are giving up permanents to do it. It is still cool. You can find decks that will make this work. There are going to be decks where you put this on 3, and your opponent has to play around it the rest of the game. But at higher levels, your opponent's going to be good at playing around it. It is worth having for your sideboard. Some decks you're going to want to side it in against. There are better sweepers in this format for the hard control decks. Yeah. It's a weird card. It can get up to a 5 in the right deck, but that deck is... requires rares. It requires good rares. And it requires a lot of hoops to jump through. You can make this work with a Planeswalker. Like, if you can activate Ursa's Seelix and seek up a Teferi, that's pretty good. But if you have a Teferi, you don't need Ursa's Seelix. It's a cool card. I like the design of it a lot. It's just not for limited. Alright, so that is it for white. We're going to move on to blue. I love this card. It's bad. Alright, Arcane Proxy. I actually went back and forth on this one a lot. It's very cool and not that great. I'm learning from my last set review to drink tea as I go. Rather than just wait until my throat gives out. Ooh. Okay. So Arcane Proxy. So the reason that this card is only a 4, I had it higher before. Hey Alba, how you doing? There is a lot of artifact support in this set. Yes. So I gave it a 4. So a lot of the prototypes I have to rank differently based on where you can cast this. So this at 7 is solid, but like a 7 mana 4/3 that casts a spell is just good. It's not busted. The thing is, most of the cards that this casts for blue-blue colorless in blue are reactive spells. They're counter spells, or if you have a way to get this up to 3 power easily, or a way to cast it on 7, then that is worth it. But it's a lot of setup. You have to set up on your deck building. You have to set up by playing something beforehand. And you have to get it down. So if you play this for a 7 mana 4/3 and you don't have a great spell, like if you're just getting a draw spell, that's solid. 7 mana 4/3 draw card is not good enough. A 7 mana 4/3 kill something and draw a card, or draw 2 cards, discard a card, make a power stone, that's pretty good. Or even like 4 mana, there's the 4 mana tap down 2 creatures, that's good. But the reason that I gave it a 7 with some medium effort is you have to set up for it. Like, you need power stones and a spell, and you need to build your deck to do both of those things, or you need a two-color deck that can cast this on three. So I had it at a five or a six before, but there are astoundingly few spells that you can cast when you prototype this card, which makes it more of a constructed card. So, like, there's not enough targets. Like, red has two mana deal four, but most of the cheap spells that kill, like, most of the good removal spells are three mana in this set, or they are enchantments, or they are artifacts, or I agree with that, but, like, even then, a lot of those cards are like put a +1/+1 counter on a creature or bounce a permanent, and so it has good things to use with it, but, like, you can't reliably cast this on turn three and play a spell, because a lot of the spells that you play on turn two are counter a spell with CMC 4 or less. So I actually had this at a 6 until I went through the list of instances and sorceries. Card's good, but you need good instances and sorceries first. Right. So if this were, this card is really good and constructed. And if you are in a chaos draft, take this first. But specifically in this set, it's weaker than it would be in, if this card were in any other set, if this card were in Dominaria and you could get back a lightning strike, oh my god. Like, I would be excited to cast this on three for a lightning strike and on seven for a divination. But this set specifically does not have as many targets as you want. But if you first pick this and aggressively pursue targets for Arcane Proxy, it gets a little better. Or if you have, like, an Urza, or even, like, an Adaptive Automaton, some way to make this bigger when it comes in. Because if this has three power, it has more than double targets that are relevant. But all the things that cost two are, like, bounce spells. There's one uncommon burn spell. It's mostly bounce spells and counter spells that you can target. At seven, it's good. Drafna. This card is really cool. Oh, shoot. It should be medium effort. I don't know why I'm missing the effort value on Drafna. All right. So this card is not immediately apparent how strong it is. It is a two, think of it like a better version of the Raven Man. So this is a two mana 2/1, which is solid. That's good in this format. I talk a lot about these cards and what they do at different stages of the game. Drafna is one of the few cards that is amazing at every stage of the game. So if you play it as a two mana 2/1 traded with your opponent's creature, hurts a little, not the end of the world. If you're trading with your opponent's two drop, if you're trading this Drafna for your opponent's two drop, is because it's something you needed to do. Once you have Drafna in play, suddenly your opponent can't use any removal spells on your big artifacts creatures. They have to kill Drafna first, because if they use a removal spell, you can pick it up. If you have three power stones and you play an artifact, then you can copy it with Drafna. That's a 2/1. And then you can pick up the initial copy and copy it again every turn for the rest of the game. So, like, there's a 4-mana 2/3 when it comes into play, make a power stone. That feeds Drafna, and suddenly it gets a little cheaper every turn until you're at 1 mana, cast 2 2/3s, make 2 power stones. The card is a self-perpetuating engine. I gave it a 5 because you do need other artifacts, and it's a big mana investment. But once it gets going, it fuels itself really well. It's a very strong and deceptively strong card. 5-color artifacts would be sweet. There's some good 5-color artifacts deck. I want to build mono artifacts. There's enough. I think there are enough artifacts to do it. All right. I like Drafna a lot. I'm going to be first picking it all the time. Because if you first pick it, you can definitely get it up to a 7. All right. Up next is we have this Geology Enthusiast. This card is a lot like Drafna, but 3 more mana, and it fuels itself. So it's one of the only ways that just, most of the things that make more than one power stone are rare, or that repeat to make power stones are rare. Geology Enthusiast is really good. So a 5-mana 2/5 is not the best, but it does make that power stone. If you time it right, it'll make the power stone before anything kills it. And once you have that first power stone, you can activate the Geology Enthusiast, because you've just paid 5 mana for Geology Enthusiast. Geology Enthusiast makes the 6 mana, and then you get to draw a card. So in a normal game, you'll play a turn 5 Geology Enthusiast. Turn 6, you will activate Geology Enthusiast to become a 3/6 and play a land. Then they have to kill Geology Enthusiast, because otherwise, that bottom ability that grows the Geology Enthusiast and draws you a card gets cheaper every turn, because it makes a Power Stone every turn. You just want to try and be a little careful not to let them kill it the turn it comes down. It's a very cool card. Urkel! All right, so this card I had to read a few times. The cool thing about Hurgle is you don't, it doesn't exclude card types. It includes card types, which means if I cast a Mishra's Bauble or a Prophetic Prism, I can pick up artifact creatures with its ability. So in the right built deck, so like the downside to Hurgle is it won't give you more bodies in theory, but it does give you more bodies. If you, so like you can ideally get multiple cards the turn you play Hurgle, but a 3-mana 2/4 blocks well, it's a pretty good body. And if you play an instant and an artifact, a non-creature artifact on your turn, then you can draw an instant and an artifact creature one time with Hurgle, then they have done their job. And they are like, you will generate a lot of cards with Hurgle over time. If you get to leave Hurgle and play for a few turns, you're going to win. If you play on turn 3, it's because you needed that 2/4 blocker, and that's a great blocker. Otherwise, you want to play on turn 5 or 6, because you can cast a spell in the same turn. But that mode of just being a blocker is pretty good on Hurgle. So, in the story of Urza's, in the Brothers' War, that's what it is. This is the first time Hurgle meditating is when people realize magic exists. Urza's like, wait. So you meditate, and then your room is clean. And then one last time, Hurgle meditates and is like, well, fuck, this isn't going to happen. But that's the discovery of magic. That is them discovering mana. This is a very cool, big moment, and it's terrible. Like, if you can pay 10 mana for this, then your opponent will go straight to discard. They'll go straight to cleanup, which means you will get more value out of this card. So you get to time walk, and then your opponent has to go down to 7 permanents. That's not great. If you play it on your own turn, you can maybe counter a spell, but you'll have to discard your permanents on cleanup. Not a great card. I'd love to see somebody make it work, but I can't think of a way to make it happen in this set. Like, big spells that you can't cast with Power Stones are a huge liability. And making blue is really, really difficult. That's true. Like, this might be a cool card for Commander. I do like it. I think it's interesting, and I like these big set piece moments. I like cards that represent moments. So this is a cool card, not good in Limited. Don't try and make it work unless you are very sure of yourself or willing to lose a bit, which I am frequently. I'm both of those things. One with the multiverse. All right, so this is 10 mana, this is 8 mana. The difference between Hurgle's Final Meditation and One with the Multiverse is One with the Multiverse, you get to cast a free spell the turn you play it, which means you aren't doing nothing to impact the board when you have 8 mana. It can't be ramped out with Power Stones. So what you need, hang on. So I talk about bridge cards a bit. Like, if you have something like a Deathbloom Ritualist, you would need something that bridges your mana, but isn't Power Stones. And there are a few of those cards, but I think it requires one of those. And even then, it's still not fantastic. If you resolve this and untap with it, you're probably winning the game. That's a big if. But this card is not flat unplayable like Hurgle's Final Meditation is. There are going to be times and decks, control decks, maybe control decks where you don't have quite enough card advantage, or control decks where you have some sort of bridge ramp. Some way to get you to 8 mana. There's a few good ways, most of them at Rare and Mythic, though. It's a cool card. I like this one as well. This is when Urza becomes a Planeswalker. This is that moment. Or maybe after. I like this art. I like this card. It's just not that good. Free! That's right. Free spells. Alright, Sky Strike Officer. Now, this is a card. I gave it a... So this is a 5 if it's the only soldier in your deck. If this is the only soldier in your deck, then this is a 3-cost, 2-3 flyer that generates another... That generates a creature every turn. If you go turn 1 soldier, turn 2 soldier, turn 3 officer, turn 4 attack with the officer, it makes an untapped soldier, then draw a card, you're winning that game. Ceiling's an 8. If you are a dedicated soldier deck with some protection for Sky Strike Officer, this card is an 8. You're going to first pick this card like it's an 8, but it doesn't go into 100% of blue decks. That's not true. It goes into 100% of blue decks. There are uncommons that are worth picking over Sky Strike Officer if you are not a soldier deck. I know that's a lot of caveats, but it's going to happen more than you think. Card is fantastic, though. Don't sleep on it. All right, Surge Engine. I thought about making this the same rank as Skystrike Officer. This is splashable. This is not. You can't splash a Surge Engine. Like, you will run Skystrike Officer as your only blue soldier in a white-black soldier deck. But Surge Engine, you will also splash this as a creature with CMC 3 or less in white-black. But Surge Engine is a dedicated blue card. A very good dedicated blue card. A 2-mana 3-2 with Defender, not great. A 2-mana 3-2, a 3-mana 3-2 that is unblockable, great. We can stop there. We don't have to do the rest of this card. I'm kidding. Because you can pay 3-mana in to make it a 5-4. That can't be blocked. And you can pay 6-mana to draw 3 cards. Which you might not need to do, because if you attacked for 5 on turn 3 through whatever blockers they had, then on turn 4, then on turn 5, they'll die on turn 6 before you draw your cards. An unblockable 5-4 closes games fast. This card's really good. It's a mythic for a reason. Why would they print this? This card's so good. I gave it a floor of a 3 in case you're not blue, and that was stupid of me. This is a blue card. I did all of these artifacts with colors at the same time, and I regret that because of this. All right, moving on to Teferi, Temporal Pilgrim. There's not a lot to explain about this card. This card's just good. The Surge is really good. You're right, Prison. Like, I would splash blue for the Surge. But, like, look at this guy. Look at this Teferi. So in this story, thank you, Dragon Jack, who helped me learn this. In the story, Teferi can't physically go back. He sends a spirit back. So that is his -2. He's sending a spirit back. It's not like a spirit that can't do anything. It's just not his full body or power. The thing that is not immediately obvious about Teferi is you get to -2 it on your first two turns. Yeah, right? So you play Teferi, you -2 it. You untap, you draw a card, you put a counter on your Teferi, and you -2 it again. You untap, you draw a card, you put a counter on both your Teferis, and also your Teferi Planeswalker, and then you Divination, and put 2 more counters on Teferi, and then -2 Teferi to make a third Pilgrim. The thing is, keeps making Pilgrims. You will never use that ult unless you are already winning the game. So, like, you will use his ult. Yeah, because you don't have to use Teferi's activation to put loyalty on it. Every time you draw a card, for any reason, you put a loyalty counter on Teferi and grow every Pilgrim Teferi has made. This card wins the game. If you play this card on turn 5 and your opponent doesn't counter it, then you get to make a Pilgrim, which grows every turn, even if they untap and kill the Teferi. If they untap and only have creature removal and kill your Teferi's Pilgrim, you get to untap and make another Pilgrim. The Pilgrims win the game and the Teferi wins the game. Like, this is a card that wins the game that makes multiple creatures that each win the game. This card is really good. If you are in black-red and you open Teferi Pack 3, you should probably just be blue-black and splash the red, or be blue-red and splash the black. Yeah, this card's silly. This is the only 8 with no caveats I think I've ever given. Like, you had to think a little bit about it, but if you have the Teferi, then the stunned silence that your opponent has after you play the Teferi is going to be enough for you to figure out everything you need to figure out about Teferi. It's very good. All right. The Temporal Anchor. So this is the card that... So Saheeli made this to let Teferi return, basically. So this card is okay. You can cast it off of Power Stones, but triple blue means you're always going to have to play at least 3 blue. What this essentially says is on average, it says draw an extra card every turn. The filtering is relevant, but drawing a card every turn, an extra card every turn, without affecting the board the turn it comes down, is a big ask. And it's not an impossible ask. You're going to have decks that want this card. You're going to have decks with cheap interaction and bounce spells and lots of tempo that just need to keep the cards coming. So, like, if this were in Dominaria, you would draft 6 impede momentums and this card, and you would win every time. It has a place. So it's not unplayable. I'm trying to think of, like Streets of New Capenna had that hideaway card that would draw a card every turn. It's really difficult to commit this much the whole turn. Yes, it does. So it does make your exile. So it is two extra cards a turn, but like, I'm just saying on average, you're not going to necessarily get to play. So you, if they kill the Temporal Anchor, which is likely to happen, then you don't get to play those cards anymore. So it's not strictly extra cards. Like, this is a reasonable card. I gave it a 3. You can get it up to a 5 in the right deck, but like, don't play it in your aggro deck. Don't play it in, like, you want this to be either a control deck or a deck that has a whole ton of power stones and ways to play extra cards. Like, you can get it up to a 5 with some work. It's not terrible. There are some terrible draw extra cards. There are worse. This is not a format where you can waste time drawing cards. Not like Dominaria. You don't have like cost reduction creatures. If you have to plan for drawing cards, you can't take a turn off draw cards with no plan in this format. Which is why there's a lot of sets where this would be like a 7. This set is a little worse. All right, Teresian Mindbreaker. So when this is no longer the only mill spell, this is the only mill spell in the set proper. The thing about milling half, ooh, thank you so much for the follow, Slayer Fall. The thing about milling half the cards in your deck or in your opponent's library is you can't let it be your only mill spell. Like, if you mill them, if they have a 40 card deck, I mean, let's say they haven't drawn anything, you mill them 20, then 10, then 5, and that'll kill them if you're attacking with a 6/4. You can't take your turn just drawing cards, person. And yes, he would like to know my vocation. But the thing about the Temporal Anchor, it doesn't trigger Teferi. That card doesn't work with Teferi at all. It gives you extra cards every turn, but it doesn't grow it or put any loyalty on Teferi. Teferi would be very okay with me not liking the Temporal Anchor that much. All right, Teresian Mindbreaker. I gave this a pretty low rating. I went back and raised the ceiling because there are other mill cards, but they are rares and they are mythics. So if you have them, you can play this card and plan to unearth it. You don't want to plan to cast this as a 7-mana 6/4. You want to loot this away and pay 4 mana to mill half their library one time. That one half their library mill is something that I'm going to talk about later when we get to the retro artifacts. But in general, this card doesn't do enough on its own, and it is not going to be the first card you pick. The rate is bad. There are better things to do with 7 artifact mana. There are not better things to unearth for blue, blue, blue colorless, but mono blue mill is like not a thing. Like, it's not a supported archetype. There are rares that'll make it work, and we'll get to those soon. Our last blue card is Urza's Command. This card is sweet. This card is going to play so well. It's really interesting. just to run through some scenarios. If you have a 6 drop in your hand, you can end step on their. You're going to want to play this on your opponent's turn. If you have a 6 drop artifact in your hand, you go end step. I'm going to scry one, draw a card, make sure I hit my land, make a power stone. If your opponent is attacking with a 2/2 and you have a few power stones, or a 5/5, let's say your opponent's attacking with a 5/5 and you have 4 power stones, then you Urza's Command, make a construct and a power stone and block if it's a 4/4, or if your creature's only going to be a 5/5, then you can shrink them as a pseudo-fog and block. No part of this card is worth 4 mana. Any 2 parts of this card is worth 4 mana. It's really cool, and it's going to play well. All right, I'm going to sip my tea for a minute, and then we can talk about how cool Ashnod is. The art is very cool. Ashnod is so cool, and she's with Mishra like from the beginning. Like, she meets Mishra really early on, and this is her early on. So this is a set with huge creatures where a 1-mana 1/1 death touch is good. This is a Typhoid's Rat set. There's one pinger at a red. There's one red green uncommon that pings, and one black uncommon that gives creatures -1/-1. There's not good, and there's very few creatures with first strike. So a 1/1 with death touch is great. You're not going to use the second ability too often, but it'll happen. There's like a Sanitarium Skeleton variant, an artifact creature that you can return to your hand. So like maybe you'll play that on turn 2, attack with Ashnod, make a power stone early. But generally you're not going to want to trade with your opponent's 1-drop, 2-drop, or 3-drop because of her last ability. But if you can get an early power stone, then you will get to use her. Turning any random creature card into your graveyard into a zombie is awesome. So, like, this is a card that suffers a little bit in the mid-game. Like, you're not going to play this as a Typhoid Rats unless you really need that Typhoid Rat. And in general, this card is usually going to make one Power Stone or make two 3/3s and then trade up. She's very good. You're going to gain a lot of value out of Ashnod. So, like, I gave her a floor because a 4 is what I would give a Typhoid Rat in this set. A 4 is what I would give a 1-mana, 1/1 Death Touch that occasionally gains a little extra value. But that ceiling is what she's going to play at a lot more often. All right, up next is Diabolic Intent. Card's pretty bad. Like, sacrificing creature isn't huge. Like, you need two things for Diabolic Intent to be good. You need a creature that you can sacrifice, and something that is worth sacrificing a creature to get. I gave it a ceiling of 5 because there are creatures that are worth sacrificing a creature to get in this set. There's quite a few of them. You almost never want to first pick a Diabolic Intent, but like if you have a Urza's Command is not the best one, but if you have like a Sky Strike Officer in your Soldier deck, or a Steel Seraph, or a Platoon Dispenser, then it's going to be worth running that Diabolic Intent. There's also a lot of two-card combos that you can set up with Diabolic Intent. So I gave it that ceiling. Even then, you don't want to never cut something that you might ever get with a Diabolic Intent for a Diabolic Intent. Ooh. This card is awesome. It's pretty bad, but it's so cool. Typhoid Rats would be like almost at first base. It's like Fang of Shigeki in Neon Dynasty. Like, you just want things that wall and trade up. All right, so Faithful Handoff. This is the donate I always wanted. You give somebody a creature or artifact, and you draw cards equal to its CMC. So, this card is not great. Ooh, I like this emote. I need this emote. I guess I have this emote if that text command worked. So, card's not great, but it combos with a few things. There are expensive creatures that unearth, so you can unearth, attack, hand it off to them, draw 4 cards, and then it will exile at their end step. There are, if you can give them like a Sawtooth Thresher, the 3-mana 1/1 that draws a card, but actually has CMC 7, you can hand it off, draw 7 cards. It's pretty good. This is a combo draw spell, and it's expensive to use. It's not a good card, but some control decks and some decks that are good at filtering their cards, if you've got a lot of scry, if you have ways to make it work, there's going to be CMC 3 or less decks that run this card. But it's never going to be amazing. Like, if you can get 7 cards off of this, that's awesome. But it's not going to happen too often. So, average of 2. I gave it a ceiling of a 4. Should probably raise the ceiling to a 5. Because, like, if you get this to work, you're gonna, like, if you get to draw 7 cards off Faithful Handoff with a 2-card combo, you're gonna win that game. But you risk this being a dead card in your hand. So, like, I'd play this if I had 4, 6 mana value prototypes that I could cast for 2 or 3 mana. Because you do still give them a body, and you're gonna be giving them a relevant body, whether it's a 1-1 Death Touch that costs 6 or a 3-mana 1-1 Double Strike that costs 7. Gixxian Puppeteer. This is fantastic design. This is a 4-mana 4/3, and it enables both the blue-black, which is draw a second card, and the white-black archetypes, which is CMC 3 or less. You're going to get a lot of value out of this card, and this is an Esper Bridge. So, like, this bridges the two of the most powerful black archetypes. Even the self-mill out of black-green, you could argue for the second ability. So, it's very cool. I gave it a floor of 3, which would be you can occasionally use one of its triggers. You are in one of the archetypes. I gave it a 6 because on average you're going to be in 2 of the archetypes. And if you can get this to trigger consistently, if you can make it so that they don't want to kill it because you'll get something good back, but you're drawing a second card every turn, then it's an 8. You can get a lot of value out of this guy with some work. It takes work, though. Gixxian's Command. So this command is the best command we've seen so far. Every mode will save you from a game you are otherwise losing. Sipping my tea. All right, so this is the best command we've seen so far. It is not the best command. That would be awesome, Plastic. All right, this is the best command we've seen so far. So if your opponent is very aggressive and you have blockers that just can't get in, then you can wipe the board and give one of your creatures lifelink to hit. If your opponent has just a full up board and your board is empty, you can kill all the small creatures and make them sacrifice their strongest creature. If you are just behind on cards, then you can make your opponent sacrifice their strongest creature and raise dead twice. That's a 3-for-1. And if you have a creature in play and your opponent has a mostly empty board, if you're already ahead, then you can maybe kill one creature and make your creature bigger. Like, any combination, there are very few situations in this set that some combination of these two modes won't save you from. It's not a win more card. It is a save your life card. It's very cool. It's really strong. And then next we have Gix himself. This card is spectacular. You can't splash it. Like, I gave it an 8, which might be a little high, because, like, you can't open this... I'm gonna drop it to a 7. Because, like, you won't... I don't want people opening this in pack 3 and deciding that they're black now. But a 3-mana... it takes a little work to make Gix work, because this doesn't trigger once per turn. It triggers for any creature you hit them with. If you have go 1-drop, 2-drop, play Gix, draw 2 cards, you're gonna win that game. If you have 3 flyers in play, Gix, get in there, you're gonna win that game. If you draw Gix with a 4 power stones in play and you're flooding out like crazy, and you go 3-mana for Gix, black, 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 and 4, activate Gix, I'm just gonna discard all these extra lands, you're winning that game. Gix is a 3-mana 3-3 that will draw you so many cards over the course of the game. And he's either going to generate some raw card advantage or take free cards from your opponent. And so, like, unlike a lot of cards that draw too many cards, he gets to turn those cards into random cards from your opponent, even if the rest of your deck is bad. You get to play out all your removal and keep the lands and turn them into good spells out of your opponent's deck. Very strong. Okay, I actually have a theory about that person. I think it's because a lot of these are pieces, like, I think they may have made Gix 10 years ago. I think they designed the Gix card 10 years ago, and then they didn't use this art for it. So they've just been farming the best art for all of these different things that people had over the course of the years, and a lot of it comes from the best artists. This is a very nice, nice set for art. Like, this is a less tricky set. There are fewer tricky things in this set because they haven't really figured out magic yet. Like, this is individual skills and giant robots. Hostile Negotiations. This might be my favorite rare in the set. You exile the top, just because it's hard to parse from the text. You exile 3 of your cards face up, 3 of your cards face down. You get to look at the cards, and then, well, you look at both face down piles and turn one face up, and then your opponent chooses one to go into your hand. So, like, this is always 4 mana, draw 3 cards, and it's going to be, in theory, the worst pile of 3 cards. But it's a bluffing game. I gave this one a high, not because the card is bad or has deck restrictions. This card is going to be hard to play with for both players. And I don't have another card like this. Like, whatever you do, this card is going to be weird, and you're going to have games won or lost by a single yes or no decision from one of the players. But the fact that it is, you both have to make a yes or no decision is so cool. I'm gonna play this card every chance I get. I don't think everybody should, but what a cool card. This is like fact or fiction. 4-mana draw 3. I love this card. This card is so cool. Like, if you can get 3 cards out of this, like, I don't think it needs the you lose 3 life text at the bottom. I think that makes it a lot worse, because it makes it so that you can't play it against the there's very aggressive decks in this format. But, like, how you play with this is going to be so cool. I love this. I think it's so cool. It's a fantastic design. I want this at uncommon. I don't want to pay 3 life. Misery's Shadow. I think this is easily the best 2-drop in the set. If a creature an opponent controls would die, exile it is relevant. There's cards with Unearth. It's also Recursion. It's a very strong card. If your opponent plays this on this, you don't want to play this on turn 2. You want to play this when you can figure out what kind of removal spells your opponent has. It's just so efficient. Like, you can play this on turn 5 when you have 3 power stones in play. This turns power stones into damage. Card's really good. It's a reason to play a black red aggressive deck, or just a black aggressive deck in general. Great card. All right, Painful Quandary. So this is a build around card for if you are the control deck or if you are trying to beat the control deck. The thing about Painful Quandaries, we talked already, it's a lot like, hang on. Where'd you go? It's a lot like the Temporal Anchor, but a little worse because your opponent gets to make the decision. Like, this card will win you the game eventually, but you can't take turn 5 off in this format. You can't just spend turn 5 playing your Painful Quandary and not affecting the board at all, because if you're behind on the board, your opponent's just going to attack you down. And if you're ahead on the board, your opponent's going to discard the cards because you're beating them down. That being said, this has a place. If you are a heavy control deck and you've been answering your opponent's threat and you just jam Painful Quandary after you dealt with everything your opponent's done, they're going to run out of cards and life quickly. If you're a very aggressive deck with enough tempo, and maybe you're a blue-black tempo deck and you've got bounce spells, there's some good bounce spells in this format, and you've been dealing with what your opponent does as they put it down and they have irrelevant cards because you have some walls, Painful Quandary is solid. Like, there is a high ceiling on this card, even though on average it's going to be pretty bad. But it's an interesting and difficult build around. This card is spectacular in Commander. Alright. Up next, our very first 9. Ooh. You may recognize this from the preview. This card is just nuts. You play this, so this card is a 7 if you aren't black. If you are, like, this, you should never be past this card. If you are like hyper aggressive mono red, still kind of wants this card. But like, the thing is, lifelink, if we look at the downsides to a big creature, to a 7 drop, maybe your opponent is going white. Maybe your opponent has 6 1-1s in play and they're still cracking in for 5. So you play your 7 drop, and you get to block 1 of that damage. Well, actually, you get to block 8 of that damage because you're a 7-5 with lifelink. If your opponent has a big pile of chump blockers, well, you have menace. So your opponent has to sacrifice 2 creatures every turn to keep you from hitting instead of just 1. And they don't get to crack back because you have lifelink. If you are an aggressive deck and you're a little wary about curving out at 7, that might be an issue in some formats. But if you just dealt your opponent 3 and made a power stone, you play a 7 drop, they're not going to be able to pay the 7 life that it costs to kill this card. Thank you so much for the raid. Hey Ears, thanks for the raid. How you doing? I wanted to see that game. We're looking at this big worm, this stupid card. This card is so strong. This card breaks standard. This card is good with trash for treasure. Ears is playing a very nice, I actually like the look of that MOBA. Like, that's the kind of thing I like watching you people play. Aw. Because it's difficult. Like, you can't play a little bit of a game like that. Like, the thing is, you don't need to... This card is fine as a 7 drop. You can pay 7 mana for this card, and you'll be happy. It's a 7 if you're paying 7 mana for this card. It's a 9 if you can cast it on either end. Because the thing is, if you're black, it's not either end. It's both. You're going to get to play this as a 3 mana 3-3. They're going to attack for 6. Your opponent is going to either double block it, sacrificing 2 creatures, or pay 3 life to kill it. Then you're going to recur it and play it for 7 mana in the late game. This card is so good. It's my first 9. This set is not much. Okay, there is one card I might take over it. We'll get to that later. Which is funny that they can be in the same pack. All right, Razorlash Transmogrant. This card is cool. It is very aggressive. So the floor of this is a 3. If you're only playing this as a 2 mana 3-1 that recurs late in the game, it's a 3. Usually it's going to be better than that because if you are black, you are likely aggressive. You likely care about artifacts. You likely care less about blocking. You likely will be able to use power stones to return it to play. You're going to have lots of situations where you attack for 3 a few times and then feed it to one of your black sacrifice outlets, pick it up in the same turn. Or maybe on their end step. This gives you a good late game. Like, 2 mana for 3 power is what black-red aggro wants to do. It's what black-white aggro cares about. And those cards that care about cards leaving your graveyard. There are so many little synergies with this Transmogrant that it's better than just a 2 mana 3-1 that can't block. It doesn't go into every deck. Because some decks need a block. Some decks need... There's enough speed in this format that you will have to put down a blocker on turn 2 or 3, which means that you can't keep a hand where this is your only play until turn 4. but it's aggressive, it hits hard, and it comes back late. Be careful with it, but it's very strong. Terribilissa, this card's so cool. This card is not an automatic include like other things. You have to have creatures to eat. But a 5-3 menace is so hard to block when you are shooting down a creature on every attack. Like, 7 mana is a lot, but the ability to unearth it is good, because black-green will be able to mill, black-blue will be able to loot. Every color mills, self-mills a little bit. Sometimes you're just going to unearth this and attack and kill a creature, and that's awesome. Having a kill spell that you can play from your graveyard is really good. So I gave this a floor of a 3, because you will probably still play this as a 7 mana 5-3 as filler sometimes, like, just in your deck. But usually it's going to be much better than that, because usually when you build with it, you're going to have creatures to feed it, ways to mill it into your graveyard, ways to recur it, and ways to ensure that it survives attacking. If you have all of those, it's an 8. It's a great card. Because your opponent will be... Yeah, there's some really good token generators in here. There's some cool stuff to do in Sealed. So in Sealed, I think it's going to be correct to play multiple colors and run every power stone you can get your hands on. Because you want to make sure, like, it's going to be like other, in some sets, it's like play all your good cards. In this set, it's play all your good artifacts, and power stones enable that. You won't be able to play artifacts in every color, but you won't need to. Like, you don't need black mana to play this card in a white tokens deck. But I did talk about, like, the filtering, things like that prism that lets you turn, use power stones filtered into other colors, or lands that filter. Those are very good in this format. All right, Transmogrance Crown. So I almost put this in with the other artifacts. Card's just good. It's really easy to cast. It's really easy to equip with power stones. You don't have to be black to play this card. You do have to have creatures that you are turning sideways with this card. You want to be attacking. But like, if you play the 2-mana 1-2 with flash and flying, flash it in. 2 extra power is a lot on that. And the fact that they can't shock it, they can't just burn it without you drawing a card, is awesome. On average, this card is going to generate like 6 points of damage and 3 cards. That's a lot. I gave it like a 6. It's a big mana investment for that much value, but you can invest the mana and get that value out of it. Build around a little bit, put some effort in, but like 5 is its base, floor is its base, 5 is its average, and it's usually going to be a 6 in terms of the value it generates. All right, I'll be right back. I need more water, and then we will continue. I think we have 2 colors, and then the retro artifacts. Retro artifacts are numerous, but quick, because they are simple. There I am. I'm stunned that people... I mean, I'm pretty flattered that there's 13 of you here when you could be watching people play this set. All right, moving on to red. Red is cool in this format. Red is the worst color, and I'm sad about it. All right, I should have enough time on this time frame to talk a little bit about general tips. I was going to make that a second video, but I want to help you prepare for your pre-release a little, so I'll do that at the end. So if you do happen to leave during this, check out the VOD. I'll get it uploaded either late tonight or very early in the morning that you can take a look. All right, here we are with red. Artificer's Dragon. Card's fine, it's strong, you'll play it often. Like a 6-mana 4/4 flyer is something that you are okay playing if your deck generates enough power stones. Ideally, you want to be able to pump it too, so it is best with access to red mana. But that's a lot of abilities. Like a 4/4 flyer plus grow your team plus unearth, all solid. And it doesn't just fire breathe itself. It fire breathes all of your artifacts. So like if you are red generates a lot of 1/1 random 1/1s, just random creatures. Being able to pump them is really nice. And the fact that you can use your power stones and like 3 red mana to unearth and grow your team for it and 5 more damage in the air, very good. This card is what you want in the red decks. Can be a little weird because you want like power stones plus artifact creatures to get max value out of it. But if you're not getting max value out of it, it's still very strong. Brotherhoods, and I was like, I read this when I was 9 and I was, oh, that's so sweet, ears. Right. So like, I've said it a few times, but like I pretty cleanly, like this is going to be a game of a set of stages. You're going to be... Cards will feel different in the early game, in the mid game, and in the late game. Brotherhood's End, in the early game, you're going to want to wipe the board, deal 3 damage to everything. In the mid game, you're going to want to wipe the power stones. Destroy all artifacts with CMC 3 or less. The reason this is so awkward is because it's red. Like, if this were 1 red and 2, you'd see it splash a lot. But the fact that this is red, red, colorless means that it's mainly a red deck. And red really wants all of these. Red really wants power stones. Red really wants cheap creatures. It's going to be hard to find time to cast either side of this for value. But with some effort, you will find time to cast either side of this for value. Usually you're going to have to give something up. But you'll have situations where you get to kill your 2-drop. Like maybe just your 2-drop and kill 2 of their 3-drops. Or you'll get to kill a few of your power stones and all of their cards. But it's work. This is a work... Like, this card will take some work. Which is not what you want in a sweeper. It is a solid sweeper. There's going to be red-based control decks, but it's going to be a little bit difficult to make them work. My contrast is way too high. There we go. Alright, should make it a little nicer. Alright. Cool card. I love the moment. In the story, they basically figure out, oh, I've got this weak stone, and I have this might stone, and I can make energy with them. And they were just having, you know, sibling brawl, except they put the stones together. When the stones touched, they exploded. Almost killed both brothers and killed Decasia. Tragic. Alright. Draconic Destiny. So, this card's a 5. I would have given it a higher ranking, but every color has a way at common to deal with this card. Either because there's a blue arrest, a white arrest, a black exile. Red doesn't have... Like, red has ways to deal with it at uncommon. Red colorless, deal 4, exile. But it does say, every creature I play until you answer this enchantment is a... Oh, green has disenchant effects. Every creature I play until you answer this card is a threat. And a big threat. Your opponent has to have an answer for it, but like if you're on the defensive, give me something +1/+1 and flying, and giving everything +1/+1 and flying is relevant, but it also blazes every turn. So if you have a situation where you have, so there's no like artifact to deal X, there's no deal X damage with power stones. This is as close as we get. So if you have a 1/1, you get to put down the Draconic Destiny, it'll become a 2/2, and then all of your power stones deal an extra point of damage. And red kind of wants to be doing that anyway. So the ceiling is pretty high, but you want this kind of in a Power Stone deck as a finisher, because if you give your opponent time to deal with it, they'll be able to deal with it. It is still very good. Like, I gave it a 5, but I probably would have given it a 6 or 7 in other sets. It's just the interaction in the set deals with it well. It's hard to make auras good in a set where people can main deck disenchant, and this is still a good aura. Felden! This card's cool. It's usually going to be filler. If you have a low to the ground red aggro deck that doesn't want to block anyway, then Felden is good. If you have ways to power him up, then Felden is good. If you put a Draconic Destiny on it. But in general, if you play this on turn 2 and your opponent blocks it with a 2-2, you aren't guaranteed to get a hit off of it, because you only ever get one hit off of it. And if there were more ways to ping, if there were ways that are like, when you cycle this card, deal 1 damage, or tap, deal 1 damage to target creature, this card would be amazing. But there's no good, like, cheap synergy. It's even hard to fight it with other creatures. So really, Felden ends up being an aggressive attacker that will draw you some cards later. But if you get to attack into, like, in the late game, if your opponent's low enough that they have to block it and you attack into their 4-4, getting to impulse is not bad. It's possible I'm just missing a synergy here, but I didn't find anything that repeats to ping. It's a cool card, though. I like the design on it. Mechanized Warfare. All right, same reason that Felden is bad. So, you have to think about how much damage you're going to deal over the course of the game with this, and at what point is this worth a card? Like, if there were more ways to deal 1 damage to everything or ping, this card would be a lot better. There are going to be red decks that want this card, but the red aggressive decks don't want to take turn 3 off to cast a spell. They want to be playing a threat on turn 3. So what you want is a deck full of very low to the ground red cards. So you go 1 drop, 2 drop, 3 drop, 4 drop, 5 drop, Mechanized Warfare, burn spell. It's kind of awkward. It has a place, but like, you have to be very red and you have to have enough burn spells to make use of it. So I actually like the design on this card a lot, but don't pick it too high. Mishra's Command. I love this card. So this is a cool command. This is the X spell of the set. So usually this is going to be very efficient removal. But sometimes you're going to be... This is a fantastic red finisher, but it's also a good red defensive spell. So if you're dealing X damage to a planeswalker, you're happy. Like, this is one of the only clean ways that this is the only clean way that isn't a counter spell that answers Teferi, because you can shoot the Teferi and the Pilgrim at the same time with the same card. But in general, what this will do is, let's say you have a 1-1 and your opponent has a 4-4 and they're at 8 life, then you get to pay this for X equals 7, take out their blocker, and give one of your creatures plus 7 plus 0. This will open up paths to victory that you wouldn't have seen otherwise. And often it's just going to be, I'm going to deal 4 damage to your creature and loot 2. And that's fine too. So it's not quite as raw, it doesn't have as much raw power and flexibility as the other commands, but it does just flat win the game. This is so on plan for red. This is what red wants to be doing. If it could deal X damage target creature and X damage target player, it would be insane. But getting to pump a creature is has to be good. And this card is good when giving a creature plus X plus O is equivalent to dealing X damage to a player for you. Over the Top. I gave this card a 1. I would love to see someone play this. It's pretty cool. That one's cool. Alright, so Over the Top, you have to build a red deck with a very high curve and a very low curve, and that's so difficult. Like, you don't get to cheat at this card at all. You don't get to cheat the mana on this card. There's no Power Stones. There's no good way for red to make mana other than Power Stones. But red makes a lot of Power Stones, so if you have 7 Power Stones and you Over the Top, then you get to reveal 14 and they might only get to reveal 6. But the thing is, if you are a low to the ground deck with cards that made Power Stones, the thing red has going for it is burn spells. Like, you have to your good red decks will have a lot of burn spells. Yeah, this is a great commander card, and it's gonna be fun. I want to build this card and construct it. But like, this is an over the top card. It's pretty cool. I'd love to see it work. Don't try and make it work in limited unless you've got gems to burn. Grexian Dragon Engine. So I almost put this card with the other artifacts because a 3-mana 2/2 double strike is just good enough. Like, as just an artifact, you can play this card and it will be strong. If you unearth it, then you get to draw 3 cards. So like, you play this on turn 3, attack for 4 on turn 4, and they can't block because what if you have a pump spell? What if you give it plus, what if you give it a Mishra's Command for 8? If you Mishra's Command for 8, then that's 20 damage. That's not going to happen too often. But like, early game, this is a real threat, something that attacks well. Late game, you get to discard your hand, which you're already playing everything out if you're red anyway. So like, you are likely, not likely, but it is possible that by the time you have 5 lands, you have no cards in hand. So you just draw 3 cards and attack them for 4 for 5 mana. Card is spectacular, not counting the fact that it melds with Mishra. Very strong. Yeah, so these are have different floors, but I gave them the same overall rating. And the reason these have different floors is that this one you can't just jam into any deck that isn't red. But 5 mana for 6 power that stays is awesome. 5 mana for 6 power across 3 bodies is really good in red. That's what red wants to do. And 9 mana for 12 power across 3 bodies with trample should win you the game, which means that this card will still see play in dedicated Power Stone deck. So like, if you are mono blue Power Stones, which is a deck, you will still be playing the Skitterbeam Battalion. You will still play this card in your pre-release, even if you aren't red. If you can't cast this for red, you're still playing this, and it's got a floor of 6. Ceiling of 8, strong card all around. The ceiling of 8 is just, if you are red and making enough Power Stones, because 5 is still a lot for the red deck, but like, you can play this on turn 5, because one of the best red spells is 3 mana, deal 3 damage, make a Power Stone. So you can turn 3, deal, shoot your opponent, or shoot one of their creatures, turn 4, untap, with use a Power Stone to put down 6 haste power with trample. Very good card. And red just had 7, 7, 8. Red doesn't have in-between rares this time, red only has busted cards. So the Tyrant of Caravages does one of two things. It kills your opponent by shooting them for 4 and then untapping and attacking for 10. Or puts down a 4/5 blocker that kills one of their creatures. So this is a kill card, a top end for red, that also stabilizes you. It doesn't interact at all with Power Stones. It doesn't interact with much at all. It's very good though. Visions of Phyrexia. I love the art on this card. Oh, it's got Story Spotlight. I didn't know that. All right, so this card is interesting. A lot of the times with these cards, you have to wait a turn cycle to get value out of it. So like, you'll play it to be, if this were at the beginning of your upkeep, draw an extra card. The reason I like Visions of Phyrexia so much is you play it and it makes the Power Stone the turn it comes into play. So like, you immediately get the Power Stone. You do have to be pretty heavy red for this card. Like, it's not a card advantage engine you can splash in other colors, but red wants to be very low to the ground. So, there's only a few cards. So, design-wise, this card is very clever because you make the Power Stone and then on turn 5, you untap with 6 mana so you can cast your 6 mana artifacts. There's a much lower risk of hitting something you can't play when all of the expensive cards are artifacts. Actually, the only card you can hit that I'd be really upset to hit the turn after I play it is Tyrant of Caravages. But at a certain point, it's just drawing an extra card every turn. And if you happen to draw a land and you don't want to play the land from exile, maybe because you drew one at some point, then you make the Power Stone instead. It's very good. It's a good source of card advantage. All right. Short water break. Running out of energy. I'm not running out of energy. I actually have plenty of energy. I'm running out of voice. All right. So, this card is deceptive. This card is better than make X11 tokens, which this card would be okay. This is another bridge mana card. So you can't use Power Stones to make this, but it makes Forest Dryads. So it makes land creatures. Yes! This makes land creatures. So there's lots of cards that we've seen that it's like, how am I going to get the mana to cast it? Well, frequently the answer is Awaken the Woods. So if you make three, so don't play this for, if you play this for X equals two, then you are getting two lands that are also 1/1s. It makes two land or elves. If you play this for X equals five, that jumps you from 7 mana to 12 mana, and there are cards that you want to play at 12 mana. But this is how you get, this is a non-power stone way to get lots of mana. So this enables a lot of cards in the set. So on average, making X 1/1s is just a 4, just a 4 or 5. If you have uses for that mana, then that ceiling jumps up to a 7. So like if you first pick it, make sure this is kind of a creature token. You'll end up with like a creature token Power Stone hybrid deck, which green-blue kind of wants to be and green-white kind of wants to be. So like this is a strong card, it is deceptively strong, and it plays very well. So like you don't want to cast this on three. You want to start casting this at X equals at X equals three. So when you play this at X equals three, you're happy. More is better though. Lots of dorks. Fade from History. So this is a card we're going to revisit. This is on the revisit list. Because if you play this card and manage this wipes both boards. There are so many artifacts and so many enchantments. So the question on Fade from History is, can you build a green deck that doesn't rely on artifacts and enchantments? And I think you can, but I think it requires rares. I think this card is really cool. I think it's got a high ceiling, but like you can't open this in pack three even if you're a green deck and slot it in. If you are only killing one of your opponent's cards, then turning it into a bear is not good enough. This card is cool. I would love to see it work a bit, but like you have to pick it first and draft around it. And passing your artifacts, that's not ideal. Like even your green cards are frequently artifacts. It's cool. I'd love to see it work. I think it can, but it's going to be difficult. It's adorable. I love the art on this. What do you think, person? Bear Force 1's good. Alright, up next is Fauna Shaman. This is my favorite art for Fauna Shaman. This is also one of my favorite arts in general. Alright, so this is a cool card. It's not great in a vacuum. It's a little bit like Diabolic Intent, but it's a much better 2-drop. Like, you don't necessarily have to have a 2-drop to play this. This is a format, like I was talking, early game, mid game, late game. You're gonna have late game creatures on turn three when you need a 2-drop, and you're gonna have 2-drops on turn 7 when you need your prototype. And Fauna Shaman lets you bridge that. It lets you convert your creatures into the creatures that you need. That's not counting, so like that's why it's a 4, because you do need to have creatures at each point in the game to search up, and you need to have creatures in your hand that you want to get rid of. The reason the ceiling is a 6 is because self-mill is a thing. Micro synergies are a thing. If you have a combo that you're trying to assemble of two creature cards, then Fauna Shaman will let you do that. And if you are just trying to get creature cards into your graveyard, then Fauna Shaman will let you do that. And it's a 2-mana 2/2, which is solid. It's a little fragile, but it's cool, and she'll do her job a lot of the time. It's a little bit harder to get her up to that 6. Like, she's going to be a 6 in that green-black mill deck. She's going to be a 4 or a 3 in green-white tokens, which means you'll still play her, but there are cards that you'll take over her. I love Fauna Shaman. I have her art on the wall next to me. Alright, Gwenna, Eyes of Gaia. Card is solid. Oh, hey, Domino Man. How you doing? I don't know what it'll take to get early access because I don't know. Being number one wasn't enough. All right. Gwenma. Gwenna, Eyes of Gaia. So she's a 3-mana 2/3. This is a set where you can jump. Jumping to 6 mana on turn 4 is relevant. Like, there are some sets where that's not going to be the case. The dream hand with Gwenna is like a 6-drop. So on turn 3, maybe you play a 5-drop on Tapper and then a 3-drop at the same turn. Maybe you play a 6-drop and then a 2-drop. But she starts attacking very quickly. And you get to pack your deck full of five, six, and seven drops without hurting your curve because of prototypes. So she's worth a first pick often because if you first pick her, you can get her to that seven pretty easily. But at her worst, she's a fantastic dork. She's a dork who gets to attack. If you get one 5 drop down, she's a 3-4 for 3. Like, and she's legendary. Very good card all around. Perennial Behemoth. Fine blocker. Not a great card. It's usually going to be a 3. Like, it's this card is usually filler. It's usually filler because you play it as a 5 drop and it blocks everything. And like, that's fine, but there's other 5 drops, there's better 5 drops. And if it's a 5 drop that you play on turn 6 and then play a land, you got a card back, but it was a land. It's better than it would be in other sets because you care about your lands after 5. But really what this card is a 5 mana blocker, which you can mill unearth on turn, like, so if you play the 2 mana 3-3, or 2 mana 1-1 that you mill 3 cards, it's that common, and you can return a land to your hand, and then you hit, or make it a 2-2, and you hit the Perennial Behemoth, then on turn 3 you get to unearth it and generate a card in addition to hitting for 2. So, like, this is a millable card that is still just fine. But, like, it's kind of weak if you're out not in the self-mill deck, and that unearthing for only 2 damage is not huge, like, because it doesn't matter that they can't kill it on the block. Cool card. There's a lot of micro synergies with it. It works well with cards that'll, like, pick it up, and it's a good blocker if you're a late-game deck. But you gotta be a pretty late-game deck. I like it. Like, this is a great card. It's a 5 if you have lots of big prototypes, and you are just trying to keep your lands coming every turn. Now, this card is great. So, Rewire Amalgam, unlike a lot of the other prototypes, you want to have access. It's best when you have access to both. But, like, a 5 mana 5/5 that you can play off Power Stone is playable in a lot of decks. It's tough to splash. It's really best in a green deck, because in a green deck, being a 2 mana 2/3 that turns into a 6/6 late in the game, and a 5 mana 5/5 that turns into a 15/15 late in the game is very good. And you're going to have situations with a pile of Power Stones where you get to cast it and activate it in the same turn to attack for 15 on an empty board. You might be able to tell when your opponent is trying to do this too, because it doesn't gain trample, which means it has to be an empty board. So if you see that your opponent is trying to Rewire Amalgam you, keep a blocker back. It's a cool card. It's very strong. All right, Simeon Simulacrum. This card is a 5 in every deck other than green. So if you aren't green, you're still pack one pick wanting this because a three mana 4/3 is just good enough. And the chance that you will end up in green is high enough, like, green's good in this set, that it is worth grabbing first pick, because this is a 3-mana 4-3, or a 3-mana 2-1 that grows a flyer, or a 3-mana 2-1 that comes back and grows a flyer later. It's just very strong and efficient all around. Teething Wormwood. I should go higher on this card. Like, it really depends on how hard it is to grow, because it's a little bit fragile for the first few turns. But, like, we talked about how 1 mana 1/1 death touch is pretty good. Like, I'd give a 1 mana 1/1 death touch a 4 in this format. So if you can reliably make it a 1 mana 1/1 death touch when it comes down in the late game, it'll trade up. It's very strong. But if you play it on turn 1, grow it on turn 2, grow it on turn 3, it just keeps getting bigger. No, I kind of like it at a 5, because neither of those, like, no. This card is very strong. I'm raising it a little bit. It's good. It's a good card. Monkey Robot. That might be true, Domino Man. We'll talk about it later. I try not to join teams in general because I don't have the time to dedicate to improving a team. Right. Artifact Typhoid Rats. It's a very cool card. Alright. So, every command we've seen so far... Well, maybe not the red one, but all the commands have been better than the last. Titania's command is very good. So what you care about most in Titania's command are these bottom two abilities. So let's say you have an empty board. You make 8 power. End. For 6 mana. Chances are you don't have an empty board. Chances are you have 2 other creatures in play, maybe 3. And that's an extra 6 power in addition to the 8-8 bears, to the 2-4-4 bears you just put down. In general... These first two modes are so situational that if you need them, they're winning you the game. So Like, if your opponent is very aggressive and you are struggling to keep up, then you can exile the graveyard, gain that much life, and also make 4 power. If they're self-mill and their deck graveyard is filled with unearthed creatures, then you get to exile their graveyard, gain a bunch of life, and still put down 4 power. If you have a 10-drop, or an 8-drop, or a 9-drop, or are missing important colors, then you get to grab 2 lands. So, this one is another... This is a little bit more proactive than Gix's Command, but it's a lot of power to put down on the board all at once. It's very strong. Here's Titania. I evaluated her completely regardless of the meld property. She's just a 3-mana 3/4 that will likely gain you 4 life over the course of the game. That's very strong. If you're the self-mill deck, she's a 3-mana 3/4 that will gain you 10 life over the course of the game. Still very strong. She's just good. She doesn't break the game. Woodcaller Automaton. Right, so this is either a 4-mana 3/3 that a 4-mana 6/6 or a 10-mana 16/16. Both of those modes are very efficient and very good on rate. You want it to be green if possible. You'll play it in heavy power stone decks, even if you're not green. You get to play this on turn 4 and untap a land, because it does untap as part of it. It's a very good card. Very efficient. You'll win games with it. All right, 30 seconds for me to drink some water, and then we will talk about the retro artifacts, which are very cool. I use the blueprint art for all the retro artifacts because I think it's cool. Alright, so, retro artifacts. The retro artifacts, there's a lot of them. They're going to be simpler to evaluate. So, a few design points on the retro artifacts. It is cool! Yeah, and they did like, this is us designing the card. Alright. Few points about the retro artifacts. They tend to be simpler than the other cards in the set, which I think was a really good design decision because Strixhaven had some of that mess stuff up. The rarity seems based most about on how they affect limited, not on how difficult they are to get elsewhere. I think that was a fantastic design choice. There's not a lot of in-between ones. There's a few in-between, but they tend to either be busted or terrible. So, Adaptive Automaton is pretty cool. This one, like, most often you'll name Soldier, but there's a few other things, like naming a Construct is really good. Naming a Assembly Worker will happen. In general, this is going to be a 3-mana 3/3 artifact, and that's good enough. It's a good card. Like, just being... It's a 3-mana 2/2 that, even if you're just pumping one other creature, like, that is often good enough because it is itself an artifact. So, like, if you just name human or whatever else you have in play, card's fine. It's best in, like, a soldier deck or if you have a bunch of creatures of the same type, because this is not an inherently tribal set besides soldiers, but, like, you'll have situations where you name golem or... Golem, soldier, human are going to be the most common names. Maybe Artificer sometimes, and there's a few elves as well. So, like, it's a good pick if you don't know what else you're doing. It's not the best card you'll see. Aetherflux Reservoir. If you have 50 life, and yet... So, if you storm enough to make Aetherflux Reservoir work, and then lose without the... Like, anytime you get to play enough spells to gain enough life to make Aetherflux Reservoir matter, then... You should be winning the game anyway. There are two situations where Aetherflux Reservoir is fine. The first is if you care about life gain. There's only a few cards that care about life gain. And they're mostly at rare. So you can combo with those. If you gain enough life to kill them with just the second ability, not with gaining life off of Aetherflux Reservoir, that can happen occasionally. That'll be very cool. I know. It is a mythic because it's... Not good and limited. I'd love to see somebody win with it, though. I'd love to try and win with it myself. All right. Altar of Dementia. So earlier I was talking about how there's no good ways... that unearthed creature, the one that mills half their library, if you mill half their library and then sack that creature to mill them 7, then they'll die. But also, if you're just like in a mid range, if you have a mid range deck and you're worried about your opponent playing a big creature, maybe some big lifelinkers, you'll frequently have board stalls that end up with you having 10, 20 power in play, and this will just kill them. So like, this is a difficult card to play with. It's a high effort. You can't run it just on its own. You run it when you don't have other ways to break a board stall, or when you have a few other mill cards, because like you can make Alter of Dementia mill 10, 15 as a way to just pour your board into their library. It's a really cool card, and there are going to be situations where you just need to sacrifice stuff. Like there are permanents where you can sacrifice it, but like there's so many little combos with this card too. Like that red dragon that pumps your team, like sometimes you will just pour 8 mana into it, pump your team, give, because if you have 5 red mana, Alter of Dementia and Dragon, and that's mill 5 per artifact creature you have in play. So like that's 9 from the dragon, 6 from 2 1/1s each. So 21, milling them 21, that'll kill them a lot of the time. So this is a good build around card. Like the effort is high, but you can build around it and make something solid. Ashnod's Altar is actually harder to use than Altar of Dementia. It's not useless. You don't want to be feeding creatures into playing a big spell with Ashnod's Altar. Like, sometimes you will. Sometimes there's going to be X spells. Ashnod's Altar combos with a lot of rares and mythics. It combos with, like, there's not a lot of X spells, but there's a few. And there's a few good ways to use Ashnod's Altar. It's good in the sack. It's okay in the sack deck, but like it's a lot of things that have to go right for this card to be strong. But you can make it happen. Standard Mill might be a thing now. I don't think these cards aren't legal in Standard. Otherwise, it would be. They are legal in Historic though. Hmm. I mean, Aetherflux strides and commandics, you only have to gain 10 life to kill someone with it. Yeah, sorry, Years. Even some of them, like Misha's Bauble, banned. They banned it in Historic flat out. All right, Astral Cornucopia. So this card was in Born of the Gods, and you may have seen it be manipulated with charge counters. So what you need for this card, so the floor on this card is low. What you need for this card to be good are preferably both of these, but only one. You need a Manalith. Like, you have to have a need for a Manalith. You have to have a need for a ramp spell that costs 3 mana, which means you're jumping to 5. The thing is, most of the times, so this would have been better in other sets, because most of the times that you are jumping from 3 to 5 mana, you will be able to do the same with Power Stone. So, like, if I can play a 3 mana 3-2 that makes a Power Stone rather than the Astral Cornucopia to jump myself to 5 mana, I will. The other thing Astral Cornucopia does is convert your Power Stones into real mana. So if you have 6 Power Stones, you can pay 6 mana into the Cornucopia and now it makes 2 mana. There's no way to manipulate charge counters. Like, if you can proliferate onto the Cornucopia, then that card gets great. But this jumps your Power Stones. Like, this is a bridge card. This bridges Power Stones into real mana. This lets you turn 3 Power Stones into enough mana to play your 10 drops. So it has a place. Blackblade Reforged. We talked yesterday about how good equipment is, because you can use Power Stones to toss equipment around. 7 mana is a lot. If your opponent blows you out when you try to equip, it's not good enough. What you need for Blackblade Reforged to work is like 3 legendary creatures to save you that 4 mana, or like 6 to 8 Power Stone generators. And if you have one or both of those things, the card is very strong. Like, you'll have situations where you go 2 drop, turn 2 Blackblade Reforged, turn 3 Legend, turn 4 Equip, and it gets +4/+4. It is very good. Bonesaw, not good enough. Don't play it if you can help it. There's a few Flying Soldiers decks that'll make it work. There's a few decks that care about playing 0 mana artifacts. You need both of those things to make it playable, and I'm dropping the floor to a 1. Burnished Heart. This is another bridge for making Power Stones work, but it is also a 2-for-1, albeit an expensive 2-for-1. You'll have situations where you play it on turn 3, turn 4, sack it. Turn 5, you have 7 mana now, and that's solid. But you have to want that mana. It is colorless mana fixing, so it is a colorless way to get the colors that you are missing. And a 3-mana 2-2 is not a great body in this format, but like it does a job. So I think this card is playable. I think you'll end up playing it a reasonable amount of the time, but it's a good idea to have some number of power stones activated and some use for the lands after you get it. There are enough ways, if you have ways to recur it and pull the lands out of your deck, then this card gets very strong. Caged Sun, constructed all-star, but in limited, it's worse in this set than it would be in most sets because such a large percentage of your creatures are artifacts. There is a subset of monocolored decks with Corrupts and the 2-mana 0/4 that grows with mountains that do want this card, and it's solid in the monocolored artifact decks. But it doesn't grow. It's really awkward because in general, if you are a, the reason that you can be a monocolored deck in this format is because so many of the good cards you're running are artifacts. And if this card doesn't pump your artifacts, it's not good enough. Like if this were all your creatures get +1/+1, it would be a lot better. But it's tough to make this card work. You can make it work. There's going to be situations where you can make it work, but don't run it unless you have both huge mana sinks for the late game, a reason to have doubled your mana. You have to reliably give +3/+3 the turn it comes down, which means you need probably 12 creatures of a certain color. And that's very hard to assemble. I should raise the effort on high. I'm raising the effort to high for Caged Sun because that's a lot of deck building restrictions I just listed. But it'll happen sometimes. Chromatic Lantern. Only slightly better than the Astral Cornucopia. You'll have situations where this enables a 5-color deck. But it's not going to be what you want most of the time. Chromatic Star. This is always going to be what you want. So there are so many uses for an artifact that cantrips. It triggers prowess. It triggers cards that care about you playing non-creature spells. It triggers cards that care about sacrifice. It triggers drawing a second card in your turn. It is an artifact that with converted mana cost 3 or less, so it recurs. It filters your mana when you need just a little bit of off color to cast that prototype in the early game. This card does everything you want it to do. You're going to first pick it a lot and not be embarrassed. It turns Power Stone mana into real mana. So like you can turn 1 Chromatic Star, turn 2 make a Power Stone, turn 3 you have 4 mana now because of your Chromatic Star. Card is better than it's ever been in this format. It's not that there is an equipped deck, Alva. It's that equipment is just good because you can use Power Stones to throw it around. So, like, there's lots of cheap flyers in this format, like Ornithopters in this format. So, like, you can build an equipment deck, but really having a couple equipment in your deck is a good idea. Nothing benefits from equip. Like, nothing says equal to the number of equipment you control. There's one card, actually. There's one other equipment at uncommon that gives you +1/+1 for each equipment and aura attached. But in general, you don't want that many. You just being able to throw your equipment around with Power Stones is really good. Cloud Key. I actually didn't finish his entry, but it's not good enough. Like, I would love to see someone draft a Storm deck. I think it's possible to draft a Storm deck, but it's going to be so difficult because you need all of these cards and these are only one per pack. It's just not good enough. Like, it's a Manalith. It's a mana rock. Like, treat this as a mana rock. It reduces. You get to choose artifacts, and then you can play your 5-drop in turn 3, but there's so many better mana rocks available. Defense Grid. Fantastic and constructed. Terrible and limited. There's so few spells that it matters for this to turn off, and all of them are cards your opponent will cast through the Defense Grid anyway. Like, this is 2 mana, your opponent will pay 3 mana at some point in the future. Oh, I didn't finish great. I guess I didn't finish these. I thought I did. Terrible. Please play it. No, don't play it. Like, this is a card. This is a card that you can build around, but it's tough. So there's a few cards that work with it. Something like Chromatic Lantern, or if you're making enough Power Stones. But the thing is, if you have access to white, white, blue, blue, black, black, red, red, green, green, there are 10 mana artifact creatures that attack for 20 in this set. There are 10 mana 10/10s at uncommon, which is unfortunate for Door to Nothingness. I love Door to Nothingness, though. It's such a cool card. Elsewhere Flask. So this card is good for all of the reasons that I just listed for Chromatic Star. I'm raising Chromatic Star up to a 6. Chromatic Star is so good. Chromatic Star is a first pick. Elsewhere Flask is not quite a first pick because it does cantrip. Elsewhere Flask cantrips and does all. It's good for all the reasons I just said, but it doesn't fix your mana quite as well, and it doesn't filter the Power Stone mana quite as well. But it still triggers Prowess, still triggers drawing a second card in a turn, still comes back for CMC 3 or less. One thing Elsewhere Flask does is enable Corrupt. So the cycle of cards that care about having a certain number of land types. So like, if I have two Elsewhere Flask in my deck, suddenly it's worth playing Corrupt in my black-white deck. So if I have like three Corrupt and four Swamps and two Elsewhere Flask, like, you can play Corrupt. The Corrupt isn't good when you have to kill their 4-4 with only four Swamps in play, but it's reasonable. It's a reasonable kill spell for six mana, and sometimes you're gonna have to do it anyway. Elsewhere Flask says, well, I get to keep both. I get to use my Corrupt to kill them in the late game on turn 10, to target it at my opponent's face for 10 damage, in addition to using it to kill a creature with only four Swamps. It was a really interesting include here. I would love to see that ears. They beat Elsewhere Flask or Jordan Nothingness. All right, Foundry Inspector. Card is just good. Think of it as a 3-mana 3-2 dork. It's a 3-mana 3-2 that lets you cast all your spells pretty well. I might lower it a little because it's kind of fragile, but like, it's a strong card. You will usually get 3-mana out of this card over the course of the game. Gilded Lotus. This is a bridge card. If you need ways to turn your Power Stones into better mana, into more colorful mana, card is fine. It is a reasonable... Like, generally, Gilded Lotus is not playable in a given set because you play on turn 5 for what reason? But in this set, you play on turn 5, now you have 6, you have 9 mana on turn 6. And that hasn't been relevant for a long time, but it's relevant in this set. So it does have a place. I'm actually raising it up to a 3 because it has a place. Goblin Charbelcher. So this is a grind card because what it does is you play it down. You can use Power Stones for it. It's not great. It's best in a red deck. But if you are a grindy control deck, this will kill your opponent eventually. And it will kill the creature you needed to kill eventually. There's that Futurama meme that scene in Futurama where he said, okay, you will be executed when this random number generator reaches 0. That's what Goblin Charbelcher feels like. You generate random numbers, and eventually you get the number that you need. I like the way it plays. You don't usually want to play it. It's best in the Power Stone deck, and it's best in a Power Stone red deck, which is awkward. Helm of the Host. Now, this is a way to grind. If you manage to play Helm of the Host and get it onto a creature that they don't kill in response, you win the game. Because you just generate a body every turn. And if it doesn't have to be a particularly strong creature, but you can put this on anything, it'll win the game. If you played this card in Dominaria, you know. You gotta pay attention. You have to be a little careful. But it does win the game eventually. And I'm raising the ceiling a little bit, but I'm keeping the regular score. Howling Mine. Normally bad. If you can find a way to tap artifacts reliably, it's solid. The thing about Howling Mine is your opponent will always get the card first. So if they care about killing it, then they'll kill it. There are places for Howling Mine in this set. There's a mill deck. It requires rares, but Howling Mine would go in there. There are low-to-the-ground aggressive decks where this card is good. Historic Brawl Goblins is already, I think, top-tier ears. but Howling Mine is... wait, can we make Historic Belcher work? They are all the Zendikar lands. I might make Historic Belcher. With Power Stones. Oh shit, I'm making Historic Belcher. Yeah, I'm gonna make Historic Belcher. Anyway, Howling Mine, they get to draw the card first, usually not playable. Don't play it without a plan. Play it when your curve is really low and you can use all the extra cards in like a tempo deck. Play it when you are milling them. Generally, don't play it. Generally, don't. I don't think there's a good way to tap your artifacts, but if there is, then it becomes great. Ichor Wellspring. All right, so I gave this one a 5. It doesn't do all of the things that the other cantrip artifacts that we just looked at do. But it does generate card advantage in the black-red sack deck. So this is a 5 generally. Everybody will want this card. It goes into every deck. If you are the black-red sacrifice and artifact deck, this goes up to a 7. It's very good in that deck and it's really good everywhere else. Just being an artifact that draws a card is relevant. Inspiring Statuary. So this is a bridge, but it's a weird bridge because it lets you use your power stones to cast your non-artifact spells, but it doesn't let you use them for abilities. It's Manolith most of the time. Like, most of the time, this is a bad piece of ramp because it doesn't let you... So, like, Inspiring Statuary in other sets was worth playing because, like, it would let you play your 5-drop on turn 4. Inspiring Statuary specifically does not let you play your 5-drop on turn 4 because all the good 5-drops are artifacts and you can't use Inspiring Statuary to cast artifacts. There are going to be decks... Like, if you have that green-green X spell... That card is really good with Inspiring Statuary. There's a few X spells that are good with Inspiring Statuary. Most of the cards that you would normally use Inspiring Statuary to cast are artifacts in this set. So it's a little worse than usual, but there are going to be decks where it's good enough. Ivory Tower. Card's not great. If you get this to be... If you get a heavy control deck with lots of card advantage, and this is gain 3 life every turn for 1 mana, card's good. Otherwise, it's not playable. Heavy control decks want it, and that's it. If you are at your pre-release and you don't and you have this in your pool and you don't have enough early game plays against your opponent's aggro deck, you can side it in. But otherwise, not good enough. Dillum Tome. It triggers the second draw step each turn. Triggers the second draw cards and triggers the mill card, like the self-milk stuff. But you don't. You need Dillum Tome to be in one of those decks and to have Power Stones. And those are three factors that are tough to meet. For a mediocre card, but if you have the cards anyway, you can include it. But there are better versions of this card too. So like, this is, things are a lot of weird things have to come together for Dillum Tome to be playable. Normally don't worry about it. Journeyer's Kite, a little better than Dillum Tome, not by much. It does generate card advantage, and there are decks that generate Power Stones and care about having a lot of lands. Like, this is comparable to a 2-mana artifact that you can pay 3 to draw a card every turn, but you have to want the fixing and you have to want a lot of lands in the late game, so it's not usually great. Keening Stone. Now, this is a good mill card. If you pay 6 mana for a Keening Stone, like, the board has to be stable, and paying 6 mana for an artifact that doesn't affect the board the turn it comes down is a lot, but... If you're playing a normal game, your opponent's going to have 5 cards in the graveyard. So you mill them 5, then 10, then 20. That's 3 activations to kill them. You will usually kill them within 3 activations. So it is a solid card if you've got the Power Stones for it. Weirdly, it doesn't go that well with other mill. It's just not necessary to have other mill for Keening Stone to be a lethal card. It's a slow card. It's a good way to close out a slow game. So you want to make sure you're in a slow game before you play it. That's true, person. Ivory Tower is good in decks that have no hand limit. Those aren't going to be very often in draft, but it is a reasonable point. Key to the City. So this is a cool card. It essentially taps to give something unblockable because you get to you do have to discard, but then when it becomes untapped, you get to loot. There's a few ways to untap it, not a lot, but there's also cards that care about drawing a second card in a turn, and cards that are in decks that care about discarding cards to the graveyard. So, like, Key to the City is very strong in this set. If you first pick it, you'll be able to play with those cards a lot. But this is also a set where decks are going to struggle to close out a game. And Key to the City closes out games. It's very strong. I mean, like, I gave it a 4 because you're limited on how many finishers like that you can run. But this is a good one. Liquid Metal Coating. So, I gave this a 3 even though it's useless in a lot of decks because this is a hell of a build around. If you can pick up... Like, if you have... I love Awesome Draft, so I first pick a little Liquid Metal Coating, and I second pick a Liquid Metal Coating, and then third pick, and fourth pick, and fifth pick, and sixth pick, and seventh pick are all disenchants. Because it just turns your cards into relevant... It turns new cards relevant. I think it's very cool. It's a build around. This is a build around card. Lodestone Golem. Normally, it's better. Generally, if you're, like, an aggro deck, you're going to... This is a 4-mana 5-3. It's going to affect you both kind of equally. If you build your deck right, it can affect you hardly at all. but there's still the chance that your opponent will be hardly affected at all. But a 4-mana 5-3 is fine. Maze Mind Tome. Card's just good. Generally, you want to scry the turn it comes down. This is going to be scry 1, draw 3 cards, gain 4 life, or scry 2, draw 2 cards, gain 4 life. Like, the gaining 4 life really makes you feel better about taking turns off to draw cards. Card is great. It's going to be great. Usually, it's good in cube. Mesmeric Orb. Now, this is a heavy mill card. It's symmetrical, and it's tough to break the symmetry. And the only way to break the symmetry is to have other mill cards. So, like, this combos with other mill cards. All of the mill cards are rares. If you are the self-mill deck, this card doesn't do a lot, and you have to be really careful. This card is hard to play with and against, but it mills a lot, and it's pretty cool. I really like it. Millstone. Not the best mill. You'll play it some of the time in the other mill deck. You never want this to be your only mill card. It is not efficient enough to mill yourself. You play this. You don't play this. This card's bad. Like, you might be able to make it work in a dedicated mill deck with Power Stones, but dedicated mill decks require so many rares, and you're going to have to take the rares before the millstone. Mind's Eye. So this is another draw an extra card each turn, but it's 5 mana to draw an extra card each turn, and you have to keep paying mana in every turn. There are going to be control decks where you want this because it does generate a lot of card advantage, but there are... That's true, person. If your opponent self-mills, you do get to play it. This is a very slow card. You are going to have better sources of card advantage, and there's even better versions of this card, because taking up one of your mana every turn, even if it's a Power Stone, is a lot. But sometimes you do just want to grind. There are going to be decks where this card is a good source of card advantage, but there are better versions of this card at lower rarities. Mishra's Bauble. This is a free card that triggers artifact ETBs. It triggers your second draw if you time it right. It triggers all the prowess and also is a 0-mana artifact. Card is just fantastic. It's always... If it's a floor, it's because you have 0 synergies at all with it. And if you have 0 synergies at all with it, then you are running a 39-card deck and your deck is just more consistent. Because you do get a little bit of information too. Mishra's Bauble is going to be a common first pick. Very good all around. Mox Amber. If you have like 7 legendary creatures, so like this card is playable when you have 7 or more legendary creatures. That's hard to do, but it's not impossible in this set. You really do want to have a lot of ways to turn it on. You should pick this in paper though, because it's worth some money. Not so much online. Mystic Forge. I'm so excited to first pick this card and play a Mystic Forge deck. You need to get 4 artifacts out of this deck. But being able to... The information... So, if you can get 4 artifacts out of Mystic Forge, the card is good. Cards are 6. Because you can also get to know the future. You can see what card's on top. And exiling the top card of your library when you know what's on top is awesome. There's a few interactions even with that. Card is solid and it's a good build around. If you're not building around it, like if you don't have 17 artifacts, you can make 15 artifacts work. If you don't have 15 artifacts in your deck, don't bother with it. If you first pick it, you'll be able to get 15 artifacts into your deck. Ornithopter. Not good. There's going to be some decks that care about it, but usually because of rares. There's some rare equipment that makes it work. There are that 3-mana 2-1, like putting 2 counters on an Ornithopter is really solid. But you don't want the Ornithopter first. You need the other cards first. Perilous Vault. This is like the Urza Steelix, but it activates at instant speed. Slightly better because of it. Also, you don't need white mana to activate it. And it exiles the permanents instead of destroying them. But it doesn't destroy your lands, which means if you are a dedicated control deck ramping out lands, you can still run the Perilous Vault. It has slightly more places than Urza Steelix. Urza Steelix is best when you also have a Planeswalker. Phyrexian Processor. This is going to be a card that a lot of streamers are torn on. This was once one of the best like cards ever. How much life you pay is going to be a difficult thing to decide. Paying 18 life is never correct. Generally, your magic numbers are 4, 5, 7, and 10. So 10 life would be if your opponent has an empty board or does not have white, like if your opponent doesn't seem like they can disenchant it or just deal with it, then you start turning out 10 tens. That's lethal in 3 turns. It's solid. This is expensive. And you have to make sure that you're not affecting the board this comes down. You're not affecting the board the turn this comes down, but if like you're up against a control deck that doesn't have disenchant, this will kill them. That is a loud person. You can pay any amount of life as long as you have that much to pay. So like the floor is a 1, the ceiling is an 8. If they're an aggro deck, you don't want this card. If you are a control deck, you do want this card. And if you are up against a mid-range or a control deck, then this card will win you the game. I think this is our highest disparity between a floor and a ceiling so far. This is a high-risk card. We'll figure it out over time. I'm going to revisit. Revoker. Cards are solid. 2-mana 2-1 solid. There's a lot of good things to turn off. You can't turn off tokens. You can't turn off power stones. Not unless they have the same name as a real card. But it's solid. Like a 2-mana 2-1, you can turn off a processor. You can turn off a Perilous Vault. You can turn off a Mystic Forge. You can turn off a Mission Bobble. You can turn off can't turn off a Mind's Eye, actually. But there's so many good things that the Revoker just turns off. So many relevant... A lot of these weren't good examples. But there are a lot of good examples of cards that the Revoker turns off in this set across creatures and artifacts. Alright, Platinum Angel. So, this should be higher than a 4. This is probably more like a 6. The thing about... No, this is right. Because Platinum Angel in a vacuum is a 7-mana 4-4 flyer. Which is a lot to pay for something that they have to kill anyway. Like, if you play a 4-4 flyer, that's something your opponents have to deal with in general. The reason that I gave it a 4 to start with a ceiling of an 8 is you can build around a Platinum Angel. Like, if you put a Swiftfoot Boots or keep ways to make it indestructible up, there are ways to make your Platinum Angel in this set unkillable, and then your opponent will just lose eventually. Like, there are not enough sweepers or sacrifice effects. And if you can even plan around specific cards, like Gix's Command is a card you can plan around to keep Platinum Angel alive. I like this one. But it is a lot. Like, this is a lot you can pay in Power Stones, and there are other things you can do for 7 mana. But if you pay a 7 mana 4-4 and your opponent pays a 7 mana 15-15, that doesn't matter. You just take 15, go to negative 15, and let Platinum Angel do a job. Precursor Golem. This is essentially a 5-mana 9-9. It's 5-mana for 3-3-3 bodies. It's much more likely that your opponent will use a removal spell to kill all three golems than you use a pump spell to pump all three golems. But you can, like, recur your Precursor Golem, and there's a lot of Sack Alice in this set. So then Scars of Mirrodin, when this set card came out, it was like a war. You would have to hold up counter spells, because then they would just kill all three of your creatures in one go. This set has enough Sack Alice. It's any golem. But if the Precursor Golem dies, like, so you're gonna have situations where you play out the golem and then just sack it and be happy with your 6 power left, so that they can't kill all three. Card is good and most decks want it. All right, Pristine Talisman. Manalith that gains life, card's fine, not usually worth playing. It's if you don't have Power Stones, you play the Talisman. Psychosis Crawler. Card's kind of awkward. I think bad shouldered. Like, the thing is, in Commander, you can keep drawing cards if you have a lot of ways to draw cards or return cards to your hand. Psychosis Crawler gets a lot better. But in general, it's going to be like, what, a 4-4 the turn you play it? And you can get it down to like a 3-3 or a 2-2. Yeah, that's true, person. Like, this card does not quite... It's just not big enough to justify the ability. And it'll be small enough by the time you play it that your opponent gets to kill it if they're afraid of the loss of life. But it's still fine. Like, usually you'll play this as a 5-mana 4-4. Drop to a 5-5, attack for 5, play a card. Attack for 5, play a card. And your opponent will answer it. So, like, I have it at a 3. There are some decks that want to draw a bunch... Like, in the double card draw deck, cards is much better. Alright, Quicksilver Amulet. This is the first time Quicksilver Amulet has been playable. It's usually going to be a 2. If you are a heavy prototype deck, like, let's say you have 6 prototypes, you're usually playing them early, like, but Quicksilver Amulet can actually save you mana. So, like, if you have 3-7 drop, so Quicksilver Amulet is usually bad because you can't run... It's usually unplayable in formats, because in most formats you can't run 8 drops. You can't run a 6 drop, 2-7 drops, and 2-8 drops, but Prototype lets you do that, and Quicksilver Amulet lets you play the back half. So this card gets good at like 7 or 8 prototypes, which is hard to assemble, but not impossible. Card is fine. You want to look at your cards and think, can I save 10 mana with Quicksilver Amulet? Because you're still paying 4. And if the answer is yes, then you can play it. Quietus Spike, similar problem. Like, if you have a good evasive, a bunch of good evasion creatures, or a lot of 1/1s that you can give Death Touch, card is fine. Otherwise, it's just going to be something that you put 6 mana into getting 1 hit in, and it doesn't... Like, if this were equipped creature has Death Touch and gets +3/+0, it would be better. But it has a place. There's some good tokens deck with it, and there's some good evasion decks with it. The same problem is, like, milling half the library. It doesn't get there on its own. Ramos. Cards is good. It does combo with Door to Nothingness. But the thing is, if you get 5 counters on your Ramos, you don't need Door to Nothingness. You can just be a 9/9. It's solid. I'm raising the ceiling a little bit because it does just grow. Like, I only gave it a 5 because it's fragile on the first turn, but it does win the game. All right, Rune Chainer's Pike. Solid build around. You want some self mill. It's worse than usual because so much of the removal is artifacts and enchantments. But if you can grow, you get like 2, 3, or 4 instant sorceries in your graveyard, then it gets really good. Like, if you're giving +2/+0 on first strike, cards are good. You're giving +4/+0 on first strike, you're winning the game. I used to play this in Constructed. It's a cool card. Scrap Trawler. At its floor, this is going to be a 3-2 that picks up an artifact when it dies. If you can get enough cheap artifacts, stuff like Elsewhere Flask, Chromatic Star, and Mishra's Bauble, so like, you'll have situations where you Elsewhere Flask, sacrifice, pick up a Chromatic Star, sacrifice, pick up a Mishra's Bauble. Like, you can generate so much value with Scrap Trawler. So if you have that, if this is just a 3-2 that picks up an artifact, it's a 4. If it's a 3-2 that lets something else pick up an artifact, it's a 5. If you have all of the cheap artifacts that draw cards, it's a 7. Card's very good. Sculpting Steel. You can't cheat on prototypes, so if you have a 3-mana 3-3 prototype, Sculpting Steel will come into play as a copy of that card. But it's relevant because both of you have targets for him. Right, person? It is a tough choice. Yeah, so Sculpting Steel is good because both people are going to be running artifacts that are relevant to copy. It plays like Clone is good. Like, a 4-mana, you have the best thing that's on the board now is good enough. Sculpting Steel is better than that in this set specifically. Self-Assembler. So, there's only 5 targets in the set. Self-Assembler itself, so if you have 2 Self-Assemblers. The 3 Urza's Tower... Like Mine Worker, Tower Worker, Power Plant Worker, and then the rare. And if you get the rare, having an extra way to grab it with Self-Assembler is awesome. It's so good. If you have multiple Self-Assemblers, it's good. Generally, it's a 3, but you can get yourself a nice Assembly Worker deck together. And then it goes up quite... I'm raising the ceiling up to a 5. Because I think this card is great if you have options. Temple Sandville. Exiling a card from your hand, there's not a situation I could come up with that was worth it in this set. So I'm actually even dropping the seal. I couldn't come up with a situation where exiling a card from your hand was worth its effect. Sigil of Valor. Card's solid. Equipment is good in this set. It's good in, like, evasive decks. There's lots of ways to make lots of creatures to make your creature huge. Pretty good all around. Soulguide Lantern is good because it cantrips for all of the reasons that the other artifact cantrip is super good. This one might... I'm even raising it a little bit because exiling their graveyard is frequently relevant. Springleaf Drum. You want, like, 15 creatures to make Springleaf Drum good? Then it's good ramp. It replaces a land if you have enough creatures, but you're not always going to have enough creatures to take out a land for it. Worth looking at. I'm lowering the floor to a 2, but I'm leaving the average at a 5. Staff Domination! I love this card. If you are a dedicated Power Stone deck, this is the payoff you want. Like, if you have 10 Power Stones in play, Staff of Domination wins you that game. I'm going to first pick Staff of Domination a lot. You probably shouldn't, because it's usually going to be a 2. But with the right deck and the right effort, it will dominate the game. There are lots of cards that are worth untapping, and there's only a few ways to untap them. There are lots of cards that gain effects from being tapped, and this is one of the only ways to tap them. Sometimes you just gain life, sometimes you just draw cards. There's a lot of different things to do here. Thundering Titan, 8 mana, 7, 10. The thing about Thundering Titan is by the time... I love it. By the time you can cast Thundering Titan, the land destruction is not super relevant. So Thundering Titan is just like... it is a big artifact threat, but there are other options for big artifact threats in this set. So what Sundering Titan is best is when you can cheat. When you are like, there's the 5 mana make 3 power stones, there's make X power stones, there's reanimation spells. When you can get Sundering Titan into play on turn 4 or 5, that's when it wins you the game. So you want to be able to cheat it into play ahead of time. If you are just stalling the game out and you can play it on turn 8, then it's not worth it. So I gave it an average of 4, because if you reanimate Sundering Titan on turn 5 and kill 2 of their lands, you're ecstatic. Swiftfoot Boots. You got to have things to protect before the boots are worth running. If you have Platinum Angel, if you have big threats, then you can bring in the boots, but they're not always going to be worth a card. Power Stone aggro decks also want this card. I'm raising the ceiling to a 5. 4 is probably right. It's still just going to be a 4. Like, it's still just a protection spell, because a lot of the times they'll kill it in response. And the Swift Boot boots, it's been better in other sets, but the boots themselves are targetable in this set. Sword of the Meek. All right, card is really cool. Being a 2 mana +1/+2 equipment for equip 2 is almost playable in this set, because you can use the power stones to throw it around. The thing Sword of the Meek does really well is everything else. So you can draw and discard a card to discard Sword of the Meek. Putting the 1/1 into play is trivial. There's a lot of good ways to do that across every color. But if you discard the Sword of the Meek to looting, then you just gained a card by returning the Sword of the Meek to play, and you get to put it out. If you are a sacrifice deck, then you can sacrifice Sword of the Meek for an effect, play out a 1/1, sacrifice Sword of the Meek for an effect, play out a 1/1. If you are the red aggro deck, there's a lot of good ways to sacrifice Sword of the Meek and a lot of good ways to put 1/1s into play. If you are the self mill deck, there are unearth cards that rummage it away and unearth cards that make 1/1s. There's a lot of good ways to take advantage of the Sword of the Meek. So I gave it a 3. If you don't have any of those, don't play Sword of the Meek. Make sure you can at the very least loot it away and play a 1/1. And there's a high disparity between the floor and the ceiling, because you can get this card, you can get a lot of value out of Sword of the Meek, but it takes work. Thorn of Amethyst. You can be a very aggressive creature-based deck, and then Thorn of Amethyst itself is not a creature. I love this card, but it is not going to do enough work. It's no Thalia. Unwinding Clock. I didn't finish this one, but you can get this up to like a 4 with some work. It's not going to be worth a card most of the time. Like, it's worth a card if you have something like Staff of Domination, or is that it? There's no other artifacts that make it worth it, but they're almost all rares. It's very hard to get. It's a lot of work to make the Unwinding Clock work. Well Lost Dreams, very slightly less work. Yeah, like if you can get it out in time to make killing their lands relevant, then Sundering Titan is good. Staff Domination is so cool. I'm so glad the card exists. Well Lost Dreams. This is a card that is in theory very powerful, but does nothing on its own. You have to have other sources of life gain. And there's kind of a limited amount of lifelink in this set, but it combos with Ivory Tower, it combos with Staff of Domination, it combos, there's a few other strong lifelinkers, there's a few ways to gain a life every turn. This is a combo card. Most of the cards it combos with are rares, but if you get an Ivory Tower and a Well of Lost Dreams, you're winning that game. You're winning that game handily. I love that this card is here because it's such a cool build around. Up next, the only card in this set that I might take over the Flesh Gorger, and that's the Phyrexian 7 drop, and that's only because I still take that card if I was black. And we have a Wyrmcoil Engine. Why would they put this in the set? No effort, it's a 6 man. So Wyrmcoil Engine would be a 9 if there were fewer ways to answer it in this set without giving your opponent the 2/3/3s. But there are a fair number of ways to answer it in the set without giving them 2/3/3s, which means that sometimes you're going to need to sacrifice it yourself. But wow, Wyrmcoil Engine is so strong. Wyrmcoil Engine is so good. Like, take Wyrmcoil Engine if you see it, play it if it's in your pool. Why would they put this card back into limited? All right, we have 3 cards left to do. They are the 3 best cards in the set. Up first, we have Titania, Gaia Incarnate. If you put Titania, Gaia Incarnate into play and don't win the game, your bath. it requires a mythic rare and a rare and a specific set of circumstances. But then it... All of those cards you mill, because both the halves of Titanium mill cards, turn into lands, and then all lands come in, and then you... they don't even... You attack and then untap with her. Like, so you attack with her for 12, and then if that doesn't kill them, because she does have Vigilance, Reach, Trample, and Haste, then you start turning all of your lands into 4/4s, and then if they have, like, let's say they have a 7/7, you attack with your 4/4, they block with their 7/7, and then your 4/4 becomes an 8/8. Because you don't have to... It doesn't say land that isn't a creature. It just says land. Why? I love it. I love that she's so strong. All right, up next we have Mishra. If you attack... If you manage to form Mishra Lost to Phyrexia and don't win the game, then you're bad. It's very hard to put a Mishra into play. But, like, choose three. So, if your opponent is able to survive... A creature being burned, all the creatures being shrunk, all of your creatures having menace and trample, two extra mana, and so this is every turn, by the way. Every turn it attacks, you get to do three of these things. Your opponent is not winning the game. All you need is a mythic rare and a rare, and to untap with them both and attack with it, and then you get to win the game with Mishra, Lost to Phyrexia. Alright. I believe in you, Alba. All right, last one. Best card in the set, Urza Planeswalker. The first that we see in Magic storyline. The very first Planeswalker. You get to activate two loyalty abilities a turn. Yeah. He does a lot of things. He does a lot of things. He does whatever you need. I like the 10. So, like... He does ult the turn after, so the turn you play him, you get to gain some life, or draw some cards, or make some soldiers, and then you can, so like, you can turn one, loot, and like, you can draw two cards, make two soldiers, and then turn two, gain two life, reduce the cost of everything, and wipe their board. Just kill it. Kill their board. Alright, so that is the full set of The Brothers War. We talked about every single card. You can catch the first half on... It's up on YouTube already. I'm going to go ahead and link it. I can swear. Yeah, so you can catch that on YouTube or on my Twitch, which I think most of you are already in my Twitch. but this was meant to be a reference. So the goal, I'll get this up on YouTube as soon as I can. And the goal is for all of you to be able to say, oh, I opened an Adaptive Automaton. Should I play this? How do I feel about this card? Should I try and make Altered Dementia work? These are all the situations that I've thought of that will make Altered Dementia work. I'm going to get my spreadsheet put together as soon as I can, but it might not be until tomorrow night. So tomorrow I'm doing my multi-draft. Four simultaneous drafts of Dominaria to say goodbye to the set. Next Sunday, a week from Sunday, is going to be my very first subscriber tournament. So if that's something that interests you, you can still get in for subscribing now. And it's going to be a pretty fun week full of spectacle and Brothers War.